Joining you in the studio tonight, you have Ian here.
And Johnson.
And Daryl.
Of course, you can join us online. Just go to freetalklive.com and enjoy the features that are waiting for you there. Those other talk show hosts, many of them want to charge you for accessing their sites, and ours is free. So go and enjoy it, freetalklive.com. Unfortunately, the internet, the free internet, was dealt yet another blow today as the Silk Road 2.0 has now been seized by federal thugs, the FBI most heavily involved in this. It's unfortunate. The Silk Road, for those who don't know, would either of you care to take a crack at describing what the Silk Road is?
Do you want to describe it? I mean, I don't know. I don't know as much about it, especially not the Silk Road 2.0.
Silk Road is, or rather it was, an online marketplace to where one could buy all sorts of substances that might not be exactly legal in most jurisdictions around the globe.
Yeah, well, not only that, but also...
And you could use cryptocurrencies to do it.
You had to, as a matter of fact. You had to use Bitcoin, and it's an underground thing, so it's on the Tor network, which means it is...
The Onion router.
Right, not accessible by your average web browser. You have to have a special web browser that ostensibly is private, but somehow the feds managed to keep ferreting out the server locations of these supposedly underground drug marketplace places, which, because you got the Silk Road that was taken down just over a year ago. It's been about 13 months. This new Silk Road...
Did they have to ferret out the server location, or could they just figure out the registration and whatnot of the domain name and just repoint the domain name a new place?
I don't really know.
I think they can just steal the .com. They can steal the domain name without...
But it's not a .com because it's on the Onion router.
Oh, right. Yeah. Okay, good point. Yeah,
it's not the same thing at all. I don't know how domain name propagation goes with the Onion router, but I imagine it's very different.
Yeah, very, very different.
Than the standard. Because the standard domain name system is very centralized, so it's easy for the feds to just swoop in and take the URL. But in this case, they actually found the server location somehow, which they also found the server location of the first Silk Road. And so that's one of the big questions that has yet to be answered. The cases, the criminal charges they're bringing against the folks that are alleged to have been operating Silk Road 1.0 and 2.0, those cases haven't gone through yet. So we haven't seen the evidence as to how they found...
Well, they've admitted how they found the initial Silk Road in some of their filings.
There's a claim about how they found it. We don't know if that's...
Well,
that's
based on
what happened.
Based on the FBI's filings in the initial case, because there were, you know, motions to dismiss saying, you know, you did this and that and you shouldn't have done it. The FBI actually admitted how they did. And it sounds very much like if you or I did it, it would be hacking. But they've written the laws in such a way as to where it doesn't apply to them.
Well, I thought that they weren't admitting to doing that, but they were saying that if they did, that it would be legal.
Right. Well, they're not saying they did hacking. They described a process, and that process is very similar to hacking, where they said they put in usernames and passwords repeatedly, and at some point there was a fail on the website, and it popped up
the IP address.
And
that was what they claimed.
If you or I did that on a website, putting in incorrect usernames and passwords repeatedly to create a situation where the website fails and gives up the IP address, that would be called hacking.
Okay, it would actually be called a brute force attack.
Maybe I'm misremembering then, because I had thought that they weren't actually admitting to doing that, that they were just, you know, saying that... You know, if they did that, that it would be legal for them to do that. But maybe I misrecall.
Well, initially, that's what they said.
Okay.
But then there was another filing just a couple of weeks ago where Ross Ulbricht, or actually his attorneys, filed and said that them finding the server violated Ross Ulbricht's Fourth Amendment rights. Mm-hmm. And they said, well, we did this, this, and this. And it doesn't violate his Fourth Amendment because he didn't claim a privacy interest on the server. And secondarily, it was in Iceland, so screw you. We can do whatever we want.
So we don't know what the vulnerability was in this new website, that how they found the new location of Silk Road 2.0 server, but ultimately they did. I did read the 33-page, most of the 33-page indictment today. on the new guy who they are accusing.
DEFCON.
His name is Blake, and DEFCON is his sort of handle. Now,
I've got some questions here about this. So,
Blake
so,
Benthal.
Were there differences? I didn't even get the chance to check out and look at the second Silk Road. I looked at the first one. I have not seen the second one at all. Were there major differences, or was it basically a clone of the
first
one?
The design was very, very similar. I would say close to a clone.
Okay. And then the other question that I would have is that I saw in the post about this happening that it was one of those site seizure logos, you know, where they have the Homeland Security and the FBI and blah, 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 blah. Were they actually serving that up? I mean, they really went and they took the time to actually put that up, or are bloggers actually just...
No, that was being served. I checked it out today.
So, wow. So they actually take the time. I mean, it's just kind of funny.
So what you're referring to is a graphic that the FBI, and in this case, actually, the Europol was also involved. So they put this big full screen, full page graphic up on the Silk Road and on other sites that they've seized over time as well. This it says, quote, "This hidden site has been seized," in all capital letters, "as part of a joint law enforcement operation by the Federal Bureau of Investigation, ICE, Homeland Security Investigations, and European law enforcement agencies acting through Europol and Eurojust," and then goes on to ramble
Look
about
at the
their,
size of our logos.
Right, and then they put their gang signs all over
We've got flags aplenty.
Yeah. So that's what it looks like, and it probably looks like the inside of a jail cell right now to Blake, who is the new alleged operator of the Silk Road, Blake Benthal, a.k.a. DEFCON. Now, people who are unfamiliar with the Silk Road 2.0's history may not realize that Silk Road 2.0 was ostensibly started by another individual calling themselves Dread Pirate Roberts. So for those who've been paying attention to this whole story for the last 3 years, you know that Dread Pirate Roberts was the name of the head of the first Silk Road, and also who they were alleging is aka Ross Ulbricht, the man who's being charged with being the first Dread Pirate Roberts. But this new Silk Road had a new, ostensibly new Dread Pirate Roberts, and he dropped off the scene after about 1 or 2 months behind the helm at Silk Road 2.0. Then DEFCON, this new guy, the man they're alleging to be DEFCON, they're saying he took over at that point and completely operated the entire site, ran it for about a year. They actually busted him almost an entire year from when the site, it may have been in exactly a year, as a matter of fact, from when the site opened its doors just about 1 month after the first Silk Road was taken out. So as I was reading through the 30-something page complaint here today, just try to get a real handle for what happened here, I think the most noteworthy thing about this is that the Silk Road 2.0 was compromised from the word go, from before the Silk Road 2.0 even opened its doors. There was an agent, an undercover agent. They don't name who this agent is.
Presumably before it got off the ground. It could have been something to where the agent was actually a confidential informant who wound up turning after it opened.
Well, yeah, I wonder if they would call a confidential informant an undercover agent. I suspect they would. I'm not sure, you know, how strict they are about using these terms, because to me that sounds different, but in legal land world, a undercover agent may also be considered a confidential informant, because what I suspect happened here is they turned somebody who was on the administrative side of Silk Road 1.0. You know, they were getting ready to bust him, and they said, look, you help us take down whatever comes next, and we'll let you off these charges. Because why else would their undercover agent be brought in as an administrator right out of the gate from the new, in the new Silk Road 2.0? That is one of the most important things to know about this case, is that it was compromised right from the very beginning. So what kind of things did that undercover agent have to do to get the level of renown that he or she would need to be let in to the sort of the back end of this website, which ultimately really helped them in gathering information, as you'll find out here in moments, against the guy they're alleging was in charge of Silk Road 2.0. Your thoughts are welcome at 855-450-FREE.
DVD, books, music, instruments, periodicals, computers, software, electronics, photo, cell phone, office products, home and garden, bed and bath, furniture, kitchen, pet supplies, automotive, hardware, apparel, shoes, jewelry, grocery, healthcare, sports and outdoors, toys, games, used and more. It's a department store at your fingertips. Shop.freetalklive.com. Get all your shopping done, get a great deal, and a portion of your purchase goes to benefit Free Talk Live when you enter Amazon via shop.freetalklive.com.
Are you searching for your soulmate? Someone you can trust, who will never betray you or cooperate with the NSA? Stop searching. With EasyDNS, you found a keeper. EasyDNS does it all. Domain names, web hosting, and managed WordPress hosting. EasyDNS stands up for your internet freedom. And with servers in Canada, they do not cooperate with the NSA. Go to EasyDNS.com. You'll love their services or get a full refund. They guarantee it. And they accept Bitcoin. That's EasyDNS.com.
Adam Miller here with Midas Resources. Today is October 29th, 2014. Gold opened at $1,223.40. A 1 ounce gold coin can be purchased for $1,268.34, $634.17 for a half ounce, or $317.09 for a quarter ounce. That's $1,268.34, $634.17, and $317.09.
Hi, this is Ted Anderson. Have you ever wondered why banks, stockbrokers, investment advisors won't talk about gold IRAs? Wait a sec. Gold and silver is going up while Congress is trying to settle on the next debt increase, and there's no end to this madness. That old 401k and IRA can be converted into physical gold without tax consequences. I explained this in my book, 10 Reasons to Buy Gold. Don't let time slip away. Call for your free copy today, 800-686-2237. Get away from that Washington spin and get honest answers about gold. 800-686-2237. The book is free, 800-686-2237.
If you're struggling to pay or haven't been making your student loan payments, listen carefully to this urgent alert. Have you been out of school for 10 or more years and you're still making your student loan payments? Are your student loans past due or even in default? Can't go back to school because of an old student loan problem? Fast Track Student Loans can get your student loans out of default, stop any wage garnishments, stop collection calls, and stop seizure of your tax refund. Give yourself a break. Stop the stress and get your student loan payments down to as little as $25 a month based on what you can afford to pay. One quick 10-minute call could help you solve your student loan problems. So call right now. Not available in all states. Payments may vary based on income. 800-215-6813. 800-215-6813. 800-215-6813. 800-215-6813.
The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. Three, give $5 a month to the AMP program. It's my firm belief that Free Talk Live's AMP program is the best use of your charitable dollar among liberty-oriented organizations. Support all the organizations you love. But make sure you give $5 a month to AMP at amp.freetalklive.com.
Are you a political activist who does things that the government might not like? Then this free ebook may save your life. Rats is your guide to protecting yourself against snitches, informers, informants, agents provocateur, narcs, finks, and similar vermin. Rats was written by OG libertarian Claire Wolfe. Rats is a short book, easy to read, and available free in many formats. Download Rats free at rats-nosnitch.com. That's rats-nosnitch.com.
You're listening to the best liberty-oriented audio streamed around the clock, on the air, and online. This is the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
This is Free Talk Live. You can bring up anything you want. Your comments on the shutdown after just 1 year of Silk Road 2.0. Certainly welcome. The number is 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. We've got Skype as well. Skype on into the show at username lrn.fm. And if you want to reach people with the ideas of liberty, you can do it effectively from the back of your car with libertystickers.com. You can reach thousands of people with a bumper sticker And, of course, you know people love to read them. Check out the vast selection of witty, poignant, pithy, and downright bombastic liberty-oriented messages at libertystickers.com. That's libertystickers.com. Ian Johnson and Daryl in the studio with you here tonight, just giving you a rundown of what I learned today, just a brief snippet, I guess, of what I learned. It was the 33-page indictment here. Not indictment, complaint. I guess there's a difference between the two.
Right. The indictment is something that's handed down by the grand jury.
So the complaint comes first.
The complaint is what is the complaint is essentially the ticket written by the police officer. In this case, the police officer being the Department of Justice, the FBI, Homeland Security, and whatever that European organization was.
So first thing that I saw the headlines coming out today and pulled up the FBI's press release, which touts how tough and bad the FBI is and that they're going to take you down if you're doing illegal drug sales online. And there's some tough talk here from Manhattan U.S. Attorney Preet Bharara, who apparently is also involved in the attack against Ross Ulbricht and the others who are alleged to have ran the Silk Road 1.0, the infamous underground drug sales website. The quote from the U.S. attorney, quote, "As alleged, Blake Benthal attempted to resurrect Silk Road, a secret website that law enforcement seized last year by running Silk Road 2.0, a nearly identical criminal enterprise. Let's be clear. This Silk Road, in whatever form, is the road to prison." Are you scared yet? You think the internet's going to back down? Is this going to be the end for illegal drug markets on the internet?
They're very scary, and obviously, every time that they try these tactics, look at how much fewer drugs we've had since they've been made illegal. You know, since they started prohibition, it always works.
Oh yeah,
right?
Nobody does crack or meth or anything.
They say scary things, and then people just stop doing them, right? I mean, you scare people, and then they're like, "Well, I'm not going to do that illegal thing anymore because a cop said something frightening."
Well, I saw a report, and this is tangentially related, saw a report a couple days ago that the opium production in Afghanistan has hit, like, the all-time record high.
Yeah, so the marketplace is going to provide other options, and for those who've been paying attention, you already know that they already are. There are several other options out there besides Silk Road 2.0. After Silk Road 1.0 went offline, was taken down last year, multiple other places popped up. Turned out some of them were scams, so you never know what you're going to get out there in the underground black market, but others are still online. There's another story at CryptoCoinsNews.com claiming that at least two other sites have been taken down by the FBI, or at the very least are displaying the very same logo, that same graphic right. We were talking about earlier, which touts their takedown. Apparently a couple of other drug sales sites, Cloud9 and Hydra. I have not visited either of those two sites, so I'm going to just take their word that they are taken down. This is, again, from CryptoCoinsNews.com. So this may all be part of a larger operation, which has been dubbed Operation Onymous, spelled O-N-Y, without the A.
Well, it's anonymous.
Yeah. So Operation Onymous, they're going after multiple deep web or deep dark web sites. The Agora Marketplace site is still online, so some of them are still operational, and Agora Marketplace, as of my check this afternoon, had over 13,000 active listings in the drugs category. There are other categories. These are not just drug sales websites. Some of them have hacking tools that they sell. Others have things like fake identification. Most of them have these things. There are some certain things that are prohibited from being sold on these sites. Like, some of them won't allow poison or child pornography and things like that. But for the most part, they are open marketplaces with very, very little regulation by the operators of the sites. So, again, the FBI has arrested a man named Blake, and they're accusing him of being the operator, Blake Benthal, of being the operator of Silk Road 2.0. We don't know about any of the other administrators of the site, except as far as whether they've been arrested or not. But what we do know is that one of their administrators was working with the federal government and may have been a paid agent.
It's funny. You mentioned some of the items that there are for sale on these websites, and a lot of people would be listening and thinking that, you know, it's so despicable. So these items are selling hacking tools that hurt people, or, you know, could potentially hurt people, and drugs, and that's so awful. And, you know, the funny thing is I think back to a story from probably a year, maybe 2 years ago. Perfectly legal, but one of the most heinous items I've ever seen, which is women selling basically positive pregnancy tests.
Oh.
There's people that sell that on Craigslist.
Right, exactly. That's what I'm saying. It's perfectly legal to sell that, and that's way more despicable than anything you're going to find on the Silk Road. You know, and it's just, it shows how there are just, there's a subset of people who have really messed up priorities. And, they think they know better than everybody else.
Well, some of them work for the federal government, and they are going to try to force their viewpoint on people. But the people behind the scenes in the black market are not going to be dismayed. They're not going to stop doing this. They didn't stop after the crackdown on the Silk Road, after multiple arrests were made of administrators or people alleged to be administrators of the Silk Road. Again, not a single one of them has been convicted thus far. So, you know, that remains to be seen. And we're going to keep you in the loop as the Ross Ulbricht case develops, and now as this new case with Blake Benthal, the alleged operator of Silk Road 2.0. A couple of interesting details besides the fact that the site was compromised by an undercover agent from the get-go, from the very beginnings of them starting discussions about how to, you know, when to launch and details about launching another site. They had an undercover agent in their midst. And that undercover agent had back-end access to the website. He pulled up, allegedly, this is according to the complaint.
If this is true, then why did they have to use a brute force attack to compromise the website?
Well, I don't think he had access to the IP of the site, or maybe he did. Maybe they just don't give that information. We don't know how they determined where the server location was.
And the brute force was on the first one, not the second one.
Right.
I thought the brute force was on the second one.
No, that was the first one. We don't yet know how the Silk Road 2.0's server was discovered.
Okay.
And we're not really sure how they did it the first time, but there's allegations, what Daryl was saying, as I understand it. I'm not
really based on filings that they've made in court, they describe something very similar to a brute force attack.
Okay.
Toll-free number, but some people said that I think there was some level of concern amongst the technical sort of community as to how they actually pulled that off and if it was really possible to do the way they said they did it, that kind of thing. But anyway, so we don't know, Johnson, this new attack, Silk Road 2.0, we don't know how the feds got access to the server, but we do know that, or to the location of the server, the physical location of it. But we do know they had a man on the inside. And there's a few other details worth sharing here. In moments, we'll get you those. 855-450-FREE is the toll-free number. Your thoughts on the underground black markets being raided. It's Free Talk Live.
With autumn in the air, it's time to think about getting ready for winter. And it's time to save at HerbalHealer.com. You'll find amazing seasonal savings to prepare you for the fight against cold and flu season. Like Oregacillin to promote lung health. 30 capsules, regularly $34.95, now only $25. HHA Olive Leaf, a natural antiviral, normally $16.95, now 60 capsules are just $12. HHA Elderberry Power, a great flu and virus fighter, regularly $16.95, 60 capsules, now $10. Save on all our homeopathic detoxes. Choose from lungs, kidney, liver, brain, libido, or whole body, normally $26.95, now just $20. Visit HerbalHealer.com and click on the Fall Winter Specials button to save on all our natural cold and flu fighting products. Also, explore our Herbal Healer Academy correspondence courses that teach you how to handle your health naturally. HerbalHealer.com, healing the world with nature, one person at a time, since 1988.
Free Press Publications is an independent, alternative media and publishing company founded in June 2009 with the mission of ensuring a free press for the freedom movement and is committed to spreading the message of peace, freedom, love, and liberty. FPP also gives new authors an avenue for publishing freedom-oriented material. FPP brings you daily news and commentary on the website fpp.cc, as well as a daily 5-minute newscast, FPP Radio News, and weekly news, views, and commentary in the FPP Freedom Minute and Peace, Love, Liberty Radio at fppradio.com, and the monthly newspaper FPP News at news.fpp.cc. Find FPP online at fpp.cc. That's fpp.cc, as in Creative Commons.
If you want to move to the free state and you're looking for some real estate, well, I know a guy who's really great. It's the realtor Mark Warden. Do you want a home with 20 acres, a lakeside cabin, any takers for renters, buyers, and sellers too? Mark Warden is the guy for you. PorcupineRealEstate.com.
You can listen to Free Talk Live on the radio, podcast, satellite, webcam, and our live streams. But did you know you can listen to Free Talk Live from any phone, anywhere? Add this number to your phone, 213-493-0308. It's a long-distance call, so make sure you're familiar with your phone's calling plan. The listen lines are airing the latest episode of Free Talk Live 24 hours a day, including our live shows. Call 213-493-0308. That's 213-493-0308. On Free Talk Live, we're bringing people to the ideas of liberty every day. From wrestling superstars like Glenn Jacobs.
You guys really are having an impact, I believe. Like I said, a lot of where I am now is due to listening to Free Talk Live. You changed my mind on some very important issues years ago.
To random people tuning in on the radio.
I was kind of stuck in the left-right paradigm. I heard your show by chance on a Saturday night. From there, I went on, joined the Free State Project, and become an amplifier. So, I mean, that's really the reason why I amp is because I know that if it wasn't for you guys being on as many stations as you are, I never would have found the ideas of liberty.
Your amp will directly change more lives by getting Free Talk Live in front of people looking for talk radio online and on the air. Find out about giving to our Google AdWords campaign at amp.freetalklive.com. That's amp.freetalklive.com.
While our satellite channel is free to listen to, it's not free for us. You can help us cover our satellite costs with the chip-in on the right side of the page at lrn.fm.
This is Free Talk Live, and you can bring up anything you want. Toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. We're talking Silk Road 2.0. They have been taken down now after just 1 year of operation, replacing the original Silk Road, which, of course, has made headlines globally for being the source of an open-air online drug marketplace that, for 2 years, the first Silk Road was untouched by federal agents. They then took down Silk Road 1.0 1 month later, after in October of 2013, a month after that, in November, Silk Road 2.0 launched. And it was kind of a rocky start for Silk Road 2.0. The captain of the ship, so to speak, Dread Pirate Roberts, he bailed out after about a month and a half or so, and then afterwards was replaced by someone calling themselves DEFCON. And it is the man who is allegedly DEFCON that they are charging, Blake Benthal, and he's looking at quite a few years in prison. If you look at the maximum sentences, one of them, there's a maximum sentence of life. And then if, you know, you look at the other sentences that are possible, he's facing multiple charges. He's looking at, yeah, a long time.
And then the minimum sentences, because all of these have minimum sentences as well. And I think most of the minimums were somewhere around 10 years.
He's facing one count of, this is from the FBI's release, the FBI and Department of Justice, one count of conspiring to commit narcotics trafficking, which has the maximum sentence of life and a minimum sentence of 10 years. One count of conspiring to commit computer hacking, which is max 5 years. One count of conspiring to traffic in fraudulent identification documents, which has a max of 15. And one count of money laundering conspiracy, which has a maximum of 20 years in prison. So there's quite a bit that this man is going to be facing here for operating what was essentially just an open-air marketplace. You could sell legal products on the Silk Road. Now, of course, they also have him in conversations, or what they're alleging is him, in conversations with an undercover agent who infiltrated the site from the very beginning, talking about how they wanted to go to other drug marketplaces and recruit some of the big vendors from the other drug marketplaces to come and sell at Silk Road 2.0. So he can't claim If they can prove this was him, he wouldn't be able to claim, well, I didn't know what they were selling on the site.
Well, I probably shouldn't make light of this because it is very serious, but I do find myself finding it highly ironic how much time these government agencies are spending asking themselves, who will build the roads?
I don't know what you mean.
The Silk Roads.
Well, somebody will.
Yes.
Somebody who is in search of
profit. But they really
want
to know who.
Somebody who's willing to take the risk of life in prison for $8 million. What was it, $8 million a month?
That's what they alleged.
Yeah.
Wow.
$8 million U.S. dollars worth of Bitcoin was sort of the average amount of traffic they were finding.
I wonder how much like major, you know, like Google, you know, like what's the revenue of some of these other, you know, it's like some, like where in the.
Google's a lot more than $8 million.
A lot more than $8 million. Yeah, I know. But what I'm wondering is like where, and I said Google because I'm thinking like one of the top revenue companies in the country, but where on the, you know, S&P 500 scale,
oh,
you know,
yeah, I don't know.
Does the Silk Road fall, you know, like if you're doing $8 million a month, you know, it was per, you know, how much, you know,
he was pulling in enough, for, you know, to be able to afford things like a Tesla. He purchased a Tesla with his Bitcoin apparently, and the feds were watching, that. And according to the story here, it was interesting because the official story from the feds essentially backed up the story given on the Silk Road. So to give you a little bit of history of what happened, after Dread Pirate Roberts 2.0 dropped out of Silk Road 2.0 and DEFCON took over, it wasn't long after that where the site was hacked and they lost a bunch of people's Bitcoin. Now, this was a pretty big, you know, this was a pretty big blow to the site. That if you lose people's Bitcoin, they're going to get upset. They're going to leave. But Silk Road 2.0, their administrators promised they were going to pay everyone back. And they did. They did pay everyone back on the Silk Road. And in fact, this the complaint here backs up that story. It wasn't just a story. The complaint verifies that in conversations with the undercover agent who was working with behind the scenes on the Silk Road, that the guy they're alleging was running Silk Road 2.0 was like, we've got to fix this. This has got to get... He put in 1,000 of his own Bitcoin just to shore up the site to help pay people back. Because, you know, obviously in an anonymous system like the Silk Road, if all of a sudden the site's admins go, whoops! Looks like we just lost all your Bitcoin.
Right.
Well, a lot of the people on the site are going to start coming up with theories about how, oh, well, this was a scam from day one.
I mean, right.
They started Silk Road 2.0 with the intention of fleecing everybody after a few months and emptying out people's wallets. But, you know, to prove that that wasn't the case, they actually did make good and pay back. So it's interesting seeing that level of honor in an anonymous black market website.
Mm.
You know, you can run these sites and nobody knows who the hell you are. It's completely anonymous for the most part, unless you've got, you know, the feds spending who knows how many hundreds of thousands of dollars trying to bring you down. But, you know, to the end user, you don't know who the hell you're dealing with. That's why some of these alternatives to the Silk Road have proven to be scams. They did set up sort of copycat sites and then let everybody load up their accounts with Bitcoin and work it for a little while, right? Like make the site was working. People were getting drugs, and so it looked like it was good. And then they just flush it, you know, just flush the whole site, empty out all the Bitcoins in people's wallets, and call it a day. They could have done that on Silk Road 2.0, but they didn't. So the federal indictment actually backs, or the federal complaint actually backs up what happened in real life, and that is that whoever it was that was running Silk Road 2.0, whether it was Blake Benthal and others or not, whoever it was really was an honorable person who really did make good on the promise to pay back thousands of site users who got the site got hacked. And it was absolutely their responsibility to do that. And it's, you know, it's refreshing to see that. And I think it's a real mark in the corner of these online marketplaces. Yeah, some of them were scams, but the ones that are the real deal, the people behind them, they're, you know, they honor their word, which is, I was impressed by that. So there was that detail, and then there was.
So just real quick, you had mentioned like how many other companies are making $8 million per month.
Okay.
So I have been doing some searching, and to sort of put this in perspective, The website The Daily Beast has annual revenue of $8 million.
Right, okay.
The largest Bitcoin rig in the world allegedly in March was bringing in about $8 million per month.
Okay.
So, you know, I'm not really sure of, you know, like major tech companies.
Sure.
How many are making $8
million? I'm not even thinking necessarily tech, you know, I'm just thinking,
you know, knowing that, you know, one of the most popular websites is only making $8 million per year.
Right.
That sort of puts it in perspective.
Sort of. I don't know. I don't know if I would necessarily, you know, because media right now is not, you know, the hugest industry to be in, especially, you know, a blog. You know, it's Daily Beast when it boils down to it. It's a blog. Mm-hmm. But still.
Right. I mean, but
it's still a major news outlet.
The most popular blog.
Yeah. Yeah. It's still a major news outlet. And they're
that's the most popular blog. Daily Beast?
It's one of them.
Yeah, one of them.
I've seen it before, but I never thought, oh, this is the best blog in the world.
It's got a pretty conservative bent to it, doesn't it? It's a conservative blog, isn't it?
I don't know.
I don't know. The Huffington Post has revenue of $30 million per year, roughly.
Okay, so that would make the Silk Road a more profitable website than Huffington Post.
And the Daily Beast combined.
By far.
Yeah. And the Daily Beast combined. All I remember about the Daily Beast is that McCain's daughter wrote for the Daily Beast for a while or something. So a
little bit more on the story here. Blake Benthal. Blake Benthal is the alleged operator here. He's 26, and he, curiously enough, was living in San Francisco, just like Ross Ulbricht, who is the man who was accused of being the operator of the first Silk Road. So there's some important details on this takedown story, and one of them goes to show, and again, these are all allegations from the feds. We don't know what's actually true here, but one of the allegations is that whoever it was that was operating the site, if it was Blake Benthal or not, whoever the DEFCON guy was being kind of sloppy and with his operational security, as it's called. And I'll tell you here in a moment what the feds are alleging he did and really did wrong. In this case, 855-450-FREE, that's coming up. You can also share your thoughts on underground drug marketplaces. It's Free Talk Live. Here's a good idea. When you have a legal matter like creating your will or legally setting up a business with a corporation or LLC, you don't necessarily need a law firm. Use LegalZoom.com. At LegalZoom.com, you answer straightforward questions online and they take care of the rest. They even review your answers for common mistakes and guarantee your satisfaction. Free Talk Live listeners, you'll get 10% off your order by typing in FTL in the referral box at purchase. Don't procrastinate with these important legal documents. LegalZoom.com.
Majid lives in Nordevin, Armenia with his wife, kids, and grandkids, all in the same house. They have cows, but to compete against the big ranchers, Majid needed to get a loan for more cattle. Free Talk Live helped him get a loan for the cows. He bought them, and now he's very happy with the expansion of his farm. You can help us help more people by getting your coffee through coffee.freetalklive.com. Make a difference, one cup at a time. Get a free pound to try out the subscription. Cancel at any time. coffee.freetalklive.com.
The experts at Web.com want to build your business a successful website for free, just like we did for these current Web.com customers.
We've used and looked at other website designers, but there's nobody better than Web.com.
Web.com can build your website in as little as 7 days free. Plus, we'll promote it on all the major search engines like Google, Yahoo, and Bing. If after 30 days you're happy, we'll continue to provide promotion, hosting, support, and maintenance, all for one low monthly fee. If not, cancel and pay nothing.
If you're in business today and you don't have a web presence, you won't be taken seriously.
Call right now and you'll also get a free .com or .net domain name for your new website powered by VeriSign, the world's leading domain name provider.
Call 800-297-0154. That's 800-297-0154.
No upfront charge for site build, after which ongoing fees apply. Rights to site are relinquished when canceled. Domain included during active service, after which fees apply.
That's 800-297-0154.
This is the Onion Week in Review. Apparently oblivious of the dismal fiscal climate, local dog Digby is wolfing down kibble as if the United States isn't in a goddamn economic crisis. Sources say the shockingly selfish 4-year-old German Shepherd appears callously unswayed by the constant stream of gloomy market forecasts and continues gorging on brand-name pet foods, milk bones, and table scraps as if the U.S. unemployment rate hasn't been above 8% for the past 3 years.
Here we are tightening our belts while this dog scarfs down bowl after bowl like the Dow Jones Industrial Average has gone through the
roof or something. You think that he'd think twice since U.S. credit rating's been downgraded, but Digby doesn't give a damn. Ain't that right, Digby? You don't give a flying f***, do you?
The Onion solemnly bids farewell to the 22 crew members who perished during the production of today's Week in Review. You will be missed. For more, visit theonion.com/newsbeat.
This is the Onion News Network.
Did you know that you can listen to and watch Free Talk Live during our live show 7 days a week from 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern via our studio cam at cam.freetalklive.com? Not only that, but you can also chat with other listeners at the same time. Do I need to mention that both the studio cam and chat room are totally free? Outside of Free Talk Live's live hours, you won't see a cam feed, but we'll hear audio from the Liberty Radio Network. So listen, watch, and chat all free at cam.freetalklive.com. That's cam.freetalklive.com.
In every age, a technology is created that upends the foundations of society. The wheel, the printing press, the internet. Now, in a world sliding into financial chaos, a new technology is changing the way monetary systems work around the world. It is called Bitcoin. Bitcoin is a new form of money controlled not by banks, governments, or corporations, but through mutual commerce between free individuals. To learn more, visit weusecoins.com.
Do you love Twitter? Make sure you favorite the LRN.FM Twitter account so you can receive our tweets at twitter.lrn.fm. That's twitter.lrn.fm.
Free Talk Live. Take control of the airwaves. Toll free, 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. Joining you tonight, it's Ian here.
And Johnson.
And Daryl.
Don't forget, you can join us online. Just drop by freetalklive.com and enjoy the features that are waiting for you there. If you like Free Talk Live, you want to help support the show, then please shop with us. Go and get your shopping taken care of over at shop.freetalklive.com. There are links to Amazon. You'll find there. There's Amazon UK, Canada, and US. You just click into the right Amazon for you, and Free Talk Live gets a cut of your purchase price. Go to shop.freetalklive.com. There are some things you can't get from Amazon, like BuzzBox coffee. In fact, you can get a free pound of it by going to coffee.freetalklive.com. You go to coffee.freetalklive.com and get signed up there. You pay the shipping cost. You get your first pound for free, sent right to you. And it's great stuff. It's shade grown, 100% organic, and top 1% grade Arabica. Plus, we've teamed up with BuzzBox and Kiva.org to help offer people in poverty an opportunity to change their own lives through microloans. So for every 10 listeners like you that signs up at coffee.freetalklive.com, we can issue one new microloan out to somebody who could use it to, you know, improve their business or make their, you know, their business better. So you can go to coffee.freetalklive.com and get signed up there. Again, you get your first pound for free, and you can help people change their lives for the better. You just pay that shipping cost, and you can cancel your subscription anytime over at coffee.freetalklive.com.
So you got to think about these things in context when you say, like, there are some things you can't get from Amazon in the context of the story that we're reading. First thing that comes to my mind.
Yeah, you probably can't get drugs from Amazon either, but that is what we're talking about tonight, the underground drug marketplaces. Although, you know, it's interesting, Angel Clark, who's a liberty-oriented talk show host, she moved down to Mexico. And she's living in Acapulco. She went to Walmart, took a picture inside Walmart of Walmart selling bongs and hookah pipes. They had a whole display of bongs and hookah pipes.
That's amazing. So
if Amazon were legally able to sell drugs like that, they may very well, but they just can't get away with that.
I wonder if anybody is selling coffee on the Silk Road, or if they were.
I couldn't tell you, actually. We could probably pull up one of their competitive marketplaces, like the Agora Marketplace, and find out what other categories they have over there.
I'm just imagining now Amazon, you know, once, because it seems pretty inevitable now that marijuana is going to be legalized in all 50 states, you know, within the foreseeable future here, and that, you know, maybe the regulations will go through for Amazon to get their drone program off the ground, and then you'll get weed delivery by drone.
Okay, I see two problems with that.
Yeah.
The first being that there's still the federal prohibitions on cannabis, okay, meaning that even if, say, Nevada legalizes cannabis and California legalizes and then, you know, Washington and Oregon, you still can't deliver across state lines without violating a federal law.
Currently, but I mean, again, it seems pretty inevitable that these laws are going away. They're gradually going away in each of the 50 states, and once we get to the 50 states, then the federal laws are probably not far
right,
behind.
But
if not, if they don't fall before we even get to all 50 states.
The feds are always so far behind on doing what is right,
yeah,
in my opinion, that, you know, they'll be definitely the last holdout of,
sure,
okay, so
the
you
bandwagon,
can grow it, but you can't take it across state lines.
Sure, they're bandwagon jumpers, and the bandwagon just needs to get rolling quickly enough is basically what needs to happen. I mean, that's what they do. They're like, well, oh, everything seems to be going in this direction. Well, this was our idea. We did it. We're responsible.
I've always supported this.
Yes.
So the toll-free number tonight, 855-450-FREE. So I wanted to tell you one of the things that was, according to the FBI's complaint, a major sloppy mistake on the part of the man who is allegedly DEFCON, who is the alleged operator of Silk Road 2.0. So they have this undercover agent. First of all, the big mistake was bringing an undercover agent.
It's also really embarrassing when your name is DEFCON and you get caught like this because, I mean, DEFCON means defense condition.
Yeah.
So obviously.
So
yeah.
This, there was a pretty big mistake that he made, allegedly, again, according to the complaint. So you've got this undercover agent. That was a mistake, you know, trusting an undercover agent. Of course, you never know, right? Like, you don't know who these people are. So he brings in an undercover agent from the very beginning of the website. This guy had administrative access to sort of the back end of the website. So he could actually see who was logged into the site. And he could see that DEFCON was logged into the site. Not only that, he could also see with what browser DEFCON was using. He had that user information about him as an admin of the site. So he notated which browser and which operating system they had. Whoever it was that was DEFCON was using a very specific operating system version that apparently was, you know, out of date. It hadn't been updated. And also a beta version of Chrome that also should have been updated but hadn't been updated. So it's kind of an unusual combination.
Right.
Is what the federal agents were saying. The most interesting thing was that had DEFCON been accessing the site through Tor, that information would have been obscured. He wasn't accessing his own website through the anonymizing system. He was using he knew the IP address of the server and apparently was connecting directly to it.
Right.
So do you understand? He wasn't using the cloak of Tor. Had he been using the Tor browser, the back end of the website that the undercover agent was looking at would have just shown him looking like all of the other Tor browsing people that were on the site. But in point of fact, he was the only person on the site who wouldn't have been using Tor because he didn't have to, but he should have, because that was what would have helped protect him and helped keep him anonymous, and it would have made it more difficult for them to connect.
Might have made it impossible.
Yeah, well, maybe. And we still don't.
It would have made it very difficult.
Mm-hmm. It would have made it harder for them to prove that he was DEFCON. And that's what they're going to obviously still have to do in court. But nonetheless, big mistake. If you're going to run one of these Tor services, you don't want to connect to the back end of the server to do your administrative work, you know, logging in. You should log in just like everybody else does to the site through the Tor system.
So I shared this earlier in the day on Facebook.
Yeah.
And I tagged Brian Sovereign because he's, you know, a tech guy.
This is Brian Sovereign from Sovereign Tech. He is one of the Free Talk Live hosts on Sunday night.
Yes. And he just responded. He used Chrome and Gmail. What kind of amateur hour is this?
Yeah, that's the other thing that's worth pointing out here is that when the FBI found the server location, they found the company that was hosting this site. And again, it's not clear how they pulled that off again on this instance. But however they did it, the hosting company, Blake's email was on the hosting account. So
wow,
this guy signed up for hosting for Silk Road 2.0 with whatever company in another country it was. Not sure which country, but it's some other foreign country. And he used his own personal email address, allegedly.
Right.
You know, this is what the feds claim. He used his own personal email address to establish that account. So he was tied to it there, and then they, you know, also found that he had certain Bitcoin accounts, right? So he had like Bitcoin wallets with mm-hmm. certain groups or whatever, and you know, there's one of them that handed over information to the feds, and in the information they handed over to the feds, they showed that someone claiming to be Blake logged into his account using the same browser version and the same operating system version, that the same strange combo of those things that they saw logging into the site with their right. undercover agent. So, I mean,
it's also strange they didn't do their own hosting, you know, like that they signed up with some random company in some, you know, foreign yeah. country is strange in and of itself, in that you figure that you could talk to some people and have some people that are friendly to your organization to set up servers to run private servers in a foreign country rather than being with a hosting company that has no idea what's going on but is seeing traffic going to and from and might be very cooperative with the feds in a raid, you know?
Right. Well, they do have, from what I understand, they do have hosts who they host hidden sites, right? So you can go on Tor, you can connect to, I don't know what they are, but I know they right. exist, that you can connect to some sort of a Tor host, somebody who will sell you hosting service. Of course, the problem, I guess, with that is that if you're not configuring your own server, then that could possibly provide security problems.
Right.
But at the same time, I don't know if you necessarily want to have the server in your house, because then, you know, that winds up coming into problems of if they find you, then it's right there. And
well, yeah, if you're going to sign up with a company, you would at least want to make a fake ID or something, right? You'd want to create some sort of fake person or corporation or something to shield you from having your own personal email address associated with the account. I mean, there have to be some hosting companies around the world who don't really care who you are, so long as you give them Bitcoin, right? Like, they're, you know, those companies exist. You don't, they're not going to ask you for your social security number if you're applying for a hosting account in Madagascar, you know? they're not going to care about that information. So find a hosting company that you can just put in any old email address and any old name and, you know, fund the account with some Bitcoin and then have them give you what you're looking for. Don't tell me that doesn't exist. 855-453, that's the toll-free number here. There's more coming up. It's Free Talk Live.
Ever wonder why so many politicians violate the U.S. Constitution? Maybe they simply don't understand its principles. Fiat empire, original intent, cultural Marxism, corporate fascism, and Molon Labe explore these issues. Featuring experts like Ron Paul, G. Edward Griffin, Edwin Vieira, Pat Buchanan, John McManus, Larry Pratt, this 12-hour, 8-DVD set is available only at moviepubs.net.
Lumber Liquidators, America's largest specialty flooring store, is using our buying power to offer great deals on over 230 hardwood and laminate floors just in time for the holidays. Get pre-finished 3/4-inch solid maple for $159 a square foot. That's more than half off other stores. Save up to 43% on our thickest and best laminates. Plus, attach padding at no extra cost. And get other incredible flooring deals. Plus, 18-month special financing. Get to your local store. These deals are going on now. Visit LumberLiquidators.com to find a store near you.
Liberty activists around the country are starting to realize politics alone won't set us free. So what will? At Liberty on the Rocks, we believe the answer starts with living your principles, spreading ideas, and connecting with those around you. By starting a Liberty on the Rocks network, you can make a difference by uniting libertarian thinkers. Find out how much fun it is to build your local network from the ground up. Visit libertyontherocks.org today to get started.
The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. Three, give $5 a month to the AMP program. You likely buy all kinds of things online. Amazon is the largest online retailer. You can get what you need at the same prices with free Super Saver shipping by going to shop.freetalklive.com. Please do your online shopping at shop.freetalklive.com.
You're listening to the live edition of Free Talk Live. Hour number two is next, after the news, here on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
This is the Liberty Beat, your daily source for Liberty news and activist updates. Online at thelibertybeat.com. I'm Brian Hagan with your Liberty Beat for Thursday, November 6, 2014. Gold is trading around $1,144, silver $15.39, and Bitcoin is trading around $338. Today's Bitcoin price brought to you by ExpressCoin, the fastest and most reliable way to buy Bitcoin. Buy Bitcoin today at ExpressCoin.com. Today's edition of the Liberty Beat brought to you by our newest sponsor, eFoods Direct. Redefining the way you think about storable food, easy to make and great tasting, with a shelf life of over 25 years. To celebrate our new partnership, eFoods Direct is offering Liberty Beat listeners 10% off their purchases. To take advantage of this exciting offer, call 800-620-5520 and mention coupon code LibertyBeat. To learn more or to buy online, visit eFoodsDirect.com. In the news, on Wednesday, thousands of protesters around the world took part in the Million Mask March, with demonstrators in Washington, D.C. and London challenging the police head-on. London police arrested 10 people after protesters clashed with police officers and allegedly committed assault. At one point, the protesters grabbed metal barriers, which separated police from the activists. In Washington, D.C., protesters also wrestled with police over metal barriers. The mass protesters in the nation's capital verbally challenged the police and called for an end to government corruption. The BBC reports Egypt's policies toward protesting citizens are under review by the Human Rights Council of the U.S.-funded United Nations. Since 2011, revolution has rocked Egypt and caused major upheaval following the ouster of longtime president Hosni Mubarak. After democratically elected Mohamed Morsi was removed by a military coup last year, military ruler President al-Sisi has been heavily criticized by U.S. and European nations for perpetrating violence against innocent protesters exercising political speech. However, the United States continues to work with al-Sisi. As during the reign of Mubarak, the United States sends Egypt roughly $3 billion in foreign aid each year. Over 2,000 people have died in the conflict in Egypt. On Tuesday, Hawaiian voters decided to ban the growing of genetically modified crops. The new measure creates a temporary moratorium on GM crops until further health and environmental studies are completed. Support for the Liberty Beat comes from Central Texas Gunworks, your online source for firearms, firearm accessories, and ammunition. They take major credit cards and now accept Bitcoin. Visit them online at shop.centraltexasgunworks.com. Support also comes from Marjorie Wildcraft's Grow Your Own Groceries. Homegrown food on every table. That's growyourowngroceries.org. This is the Liberty Beat for Thursday, November 6th, 2014. Check out the website at thelibertybeat.com and like us on Facebook at facebook.com/thelibertybeat. On Wednesday, President Barack Obama said he would work with Congress on new war powers to fight Islamic State militants and expressed cautious optimism about whether the international face-off over Iran's nuclear program will be resolved. Two issues that could prove harder for the White House to maneuver with Republicans in charge on Capitol Hill. The Associated Press reports that Obama spoke at a news conference the day after his party was thrashed by Republicans in elections, leaving the Republicans soon to be in charge of both the House and the Senate. Obama's decision will test the ability of the divided Congress to agree on a war strategy for Iraq and Syria. A St. Louis Circuit judge has ruled Missouri's ban on same-sex marriages as unconstitutional. Judge Rex Burleson called the freedom to marry a fundamental right deeply rooted in the history of the United States. The news comes a day after a federal judge ruled a similar ban in Kansas was in violation of the Constitution. On Monday, a district judge threw out an alleged 1993 confession from Daniel Villegas, the Texas man who spent 19 years behind bars for a murder he did not commit. The district judge stated that the confession could not be used as evidence in an upcoming retrial because it was coerced by police. Support for the Liberty Beat comes from Midas Resources Incorporated, helping clients convert their paper 401ks and IRAs to solid gold and silver. Get their 10 Reasons book free by calling 800-686-2237. That's 800-686-2237. Support also comes from Sovereign Living, a podcast, blog, and reality show about what it takes to live a voluntary and natural life. Check out the blog at sovereignliving.com and watch episode 1 of the soon-to-be-released reality show at sovereignliving.tv. This is the Liberty Beat for Thursday, November 6, 2014. I'm Brian Hagan, reporting. Reminding you, spread liberty with a smile.
Yeah. It's the Onion Radio News. The nation's last remaining themeless restaurant has closed. This is Doyle Redland reporting. A once vibrant era came to an end today when Pat's Place, the nation's last themeless restaurant, closed its doors in Cedar Rapids, Iowa. During the heyday of themeless restaurants, Pat's Place achieved a certain amount of notoriety for its unique non-themed food items and unadorned atmosphere. But according to owner Patrick Baines, the times have changed.
Lately, we've had only a handful of people coming in to gawk at our posterless walls and mundanely named menu items like hamburgers or pancakes. And then they go someplace like the Rainforest Cafe or Johnny Rockets to actually eat.
Plans are now in the works to convert the Pat's Place location into Cedar Rapids' seventh patio touchdown sports bar and good time internet grill. Doyle Redland for the Onion Radio News, online at theonion.com.
This is the Onion News Network.
This is Free Talk Live. You are invited here to dial in toll-free and bring up anything you want. 855-450-FREE. That's the Pro XPN toll-free line, 855-450-3733. The Silk Road 2.0 is no more. It has been taken offline, ostensibly by the FBI, Department of Homeland Security. They put up one of their big splash graphics if you actually try to go to the website. Right. To the hidden site. You cannot access this site through your regular web browser. You have to have what's called the Tor browser in order to officially be able to access this. Good news is the Tor browser is free. You can go and download that anywhere you want if you do actually want to go and see what this looks like. But it's just basically a big graphic saying, we've taken your website. Ha-ha! We'll put a stop to you, drug dealers. Well, sorry. You're not going to put a stop to anything. People who want to make a profit, people who realize that drugs are very profitable are going to take the risk. They're going to take the risk because someone in the world is going to say to themselves, $8 million of revenue per month? Well, that's not bad. Well, actually, what it turns out was $8 million was moving through the site. Right. So the site itself was not actually pulling down $8 million. The operators of the site, I think they were pulling in like 4 to 8% depending on the, you know, the transaction. So, let's call it 5% of $8 million every single month. Still not a bad take.
So that's still what, like 30 some odd thousand per month?
Yeah, at least that. At least that. I'm not good with that level of math, but I think it may be a little bit more than that.
Yeah, it's definitely more than that.
Yeah, I think that was what one.
Did
of
you
their,
say 30?
Yeah,
it's definitely like more than 30.
I think one of their agents was getting paid $30,000 a month. One of their assistants. In fact, I think it was the undercover agent who was getting paid $30,000 per month. So yeah, 5%.
Yeah, 320. Because 10% would be 800,000.
Right. Okay.
Well, 5% of 8 million is $400,000.
So $400,000. Okay.
I was off a decimal place in the math in my brain.
This is why we're talk show hosts, because we, well, anyway, let's go on.
But
with
hey,
your
that's
calls
four. That's 4.8 million a year, and then whoever knows if you're well, they're probably not making much on interest.
Yeah, that's sweet. I mean, that's pretty good for running a website.
Yeah.
And so somebody else out there is going to want to do this. In fact, there are several someone else's who are already doing it. They're just not calling their sites the Silk Road. There are a lot of other sites out there. Although news is also coming out, allegedly some of these other sites have now been taken down. Whether the FBI has actually taken them down or they have just put up FBI notices on their own websites just to call it a day and make a run for it with whoever's money was sitting on the site, that's certainly a possibility too. I don't know if I would necessarily, without having seen an official press release from the FBI about them taking down apparently sites called Cloud9 and Hydra, I don't know if I would necessarily believe it if those graphics appeared on those websites, those hidden sites as they're called. Jeremy's in Rhode Island. You're on Free Talk Live. Hello, Jeremy.
Oh, hey, Ian.
Hey, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Hey. So I hear these advertisements for Ross Ulbricht.
Yes.
And now if he's an innocent man, he's wrongfully accused and all that. But if he's innocent, I don't want to donate a cent to him. Like, let him go to prison, man.
Wait, if he's what, you don't want to donate a cent?
He said if he's innocent, he doesn't want to donate.
Yeah.
Well, why
if
not?
If he's innocent, why not get convicted so the person who actually did it can go free and, you know, continue the Silk Road legacy.
What kind
you
of
realize
a
that's
callous...
not how the justice system works, right?
What kind of a callous thing is that to say?
Innocent people all the time. It's an American... Yeah, it's an American pastime convicting innocent people.
You do realize that if he were found innocent, right, that it doesn't mean that they've found the real person. Like, your logic there is...
It seems really callous.
Not only is it callous and, like, totally morally depraved,
yeah.
But you're also just logically so far off base. That's not how the justice system works. Like, if he's found innocent, it's not like... Well, he's innocent, therefore, you know, we have the real one all of a sudden. Like, magically, we've suddenly got the real person. Or let's say he's found guilty. Well, we can just give up the search for the real guy when the new Silk Road pops up.
I don't think that's what Jeremy's saying. It sounds to me like Jeremy's just saying, screw Ross Ulbricht if he's innocent, because he'd rather see Ross Ulbricht go to jail than catch the real Dread Pirate Roberts.
Right, which doesn't make any logical sense. You see what I'm saying? Like, that doesn't make any logical sense. Like,
well, no, it makes sense from the perspective that Jeremy's, you know, basically saying, I'll sacrifice anyone to protect Dread Pirate Roberts.
Right, but you're not going to... That doesn't protect Dread Pirate Roberts. You see what I'm saying? Like,
well, no,
if he's going to go back... Because what you want to see is you want to see the site come back and have people operating the site, right? That's what you're saying you think will happen?
Jeremy?
Me?
Yes.
I just think whoever actually did it should probably go free.
But whether or not Ross Ulbricht is convicted has really nothing to do with whether or not that happens.
Well,
or not.
I guess what you're saying is, Jeremy, you think that if they convict Ross Ulbricht, they wouldn't be looking for Dread Pirate Roberts anymore.
Yeah.
Which doesn't really make sense.
I know it's become a cliche on this show, but I'd like to ask for an apology for calling him morally depraved. That's insulting.
Well, I think that you are being pretty nasty towards Ross Ulbricht here, unnecessarily, basically acting as though Dread Pirate Roberts, you know, somehow he deserves a sacrifice. And I think that's pretty depraved, personally. I didn't use that term for you, but I'll sign on with it.
I did, and I'll be okay if you ask me to come and say it to your face.
Thanks, Jeremy, for the call tonight. Toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. No, I think there's...
I should explain that that's a reference to a frequent caller by the name of Dave, who...
I don't know. Yeah, Dave from New York.
Yeah.
I think there was a miscommunication there, though. Johnson was like, you know, he was saying that he didn't believe they would keep going after Dread Pirate Roberts if they convicted Ross Ulbricht, so screw Ross Ulbricht. And I think what you were saying was that you thought that he was presuming Dread Pirate Roberts was going to continue on running the Silk Road.
They're
going
to continue looking for... Well, I mean...
You know, there's no evidence that Dread Pirate Roberts is doing anything anymore.
Right.
You know, there's no... Whoever... If Ross Ulbricht is not the original Dread Pirate Roberts, there's no evidence that whoever it was is still doing the same business. Odds are good that person has taken the money and run, but who knows?
Maybe.
Who knows? Maybe that's the person running the Agra Marketplace, which is still online tonight. So I don't know.
And who knows?
There's countless cases throughout history of people serving lengthy prison sentences only to later wind up being
released,
redeemed of, oh yeah, you didn't really do this thing.
So you can share your thoughts here tonight, as callous as they may be. We're here for you. The toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. Let's go to Jared. You are on the air. Jared, you're on Free Talk Live.
Yeah, I just wanted to call because I was listening to the podcast from November 3rd. I believe that was the one, and you guys had a SWAT team cop who called in, and he was trying to explain the whole samurai sword thing and all that.
The samurai sword thing, that was the guy who was carrying a sword and was shot to death by the police, that story?
Like the toy sword.
Well, right, but the guy was trying to say, well, the difference between police in Europe and the U.S. is guns and all that stuff. And first off, just for the facts, in Utah, you can carry knives and blades. It's just like New Hampshire. They have a knife preemption law also, so that's not a crime. As far as Europe, I mean, you know, that's kind of really painting with a huge broad brush. I mean, a lot of countries in Europe have a lot of guns, and in certain countries like the Czech Republic, it's not hard to carry a gun either, but yet their crime rate is still really, really low. I mean, and so if for the guy to say, well, police need to be more aggressive because America has a bunch of guns, well, there's plenty of places around the world where the police are a lot lot worse, and the average person doesn't have legal access to guns either. So to use that as a comparison, I think that's a good point. Way off base. What I would say from what my own opinion about what's different about Europe is not that I'm advocating a socialist state, obviously, but they don't have this drug war that we have here, number one. Number two, in the U.S., when you get out of prison, you have nothing. I mean, you don't have anything. In Europe, you can get a bridge card or whatever they would call it. So there's less incentive for people to go back to their old way of life. And also, too, I do think there's a little bit more of a respect for life in Europe. And I don't know why that is or culturally why.
Among the police, you mean? Among the police.
Yeah. I mean, Iceland, as you guys point out, only had, what, one shooting since they've been a country? Iceland has a lot of guns.
And then the police apologized for that murder.
Jared, thanks for your call and thoughts tonight. I appreciate hearing from you. Toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. More on the crackdown on the Silk Road coming up. You can take control. Free Talk Live.
Here's a special message for those of you who owe the IRS at least $10,000 or more in back taxes. The IRS has special programs in place that could eliminate or reduce your tax debt by thousands of dollars. Call the tax helpline that has been set up to help you. 800-691-6129. That's 800-691-6129. Stop the wage garnishments, levies, and tax liens now. Once you've qualified and enrolled, the IRS will stop all the collection activities against you. These unique programs have been allocated to help the economy and significantly reduce or eliminate your tax burden. The IRS is currently accepting reduced settlements and other favorable programs. You may qualify for substantial savings, so get the help you need. For free information and to see if you qualify, take down the number now for the Tax Representation Hotline. 800-691-6129. That's 800-691-6129. 800-691-6129.
Gold, it's like nothing else on Earth. From the Romans through the Renaissance, from the Industrial Age to the Space Age, gold has weathered the test of time. For 6,000 years, gold has remained the ultimate store of wealth. According to the World Gold Council and the U.S. Mint, demand is at an all-time high. The stage is being set for the reemergence of gold as the common-sense alternative to a fiat paper currency that gets weaker every day. Midas Resources is proud to offer the hard-hitting report that arms you with the truth you need to protect you and your family from the Fed's plans for your hard-earned money. Don't gamble with your future. Call Midas Resources today and ask for your free copy of As Good as Gold. Call 1-800-686-2233 for the report the Fed hopes you'll never see. As Good as Gold can be yours by calling 800-686-2237. If you have ever thought about owning gold, you must read this report. Call Midas today at 800-686-2237.
What if the key to achieving liberty in your lifetime was to move together with others who think like you? Liberty activists are joining the Free State Project, which is over 70% of the way to its goal of 20,000 participants. And they're already making the move to New Hampshire. The successes are piling up and are proving the Free State Project is a real movement and no longer just a great idea. When you're planning your move, consider Keene. Keene is famous for its civil disobedience and non-cooperation, and there's plenty of political opportunity as well. From demonstrations and vigils to outreach and volunteering, there's a lot going on in Keene. Keene is the liberty media capital of the world, with television, talk radio, and more, all originating here. Though it's more than just activism, with regular social events each week. See what's happening at freekeene.com and get connected with video, audio, free books, a forum, and activist tools you can download and use in your area at freekeene.com. That's freekeene.com. If you want to know the latest about Free Talk Live before we go on the air, all you need to decide is how you want it delivered. It's your choice. Visit news.freetalklive.com. You can get emailed announcements and participate in contests via our email updates list. Plus, we have a Twitter account that you can follow and a Facebook page where you can become a fan. So visit news.freetalklive.com to get news about Free Talk Live as soon as it's announced and the way you want it delivered at news.freetalklive.com. That's news.freetalklive.com.
Shiny badges on your jacket, shiny badges. Yeah!
This is Davi Barker from shinybadges.com, and I just want to personally apologize for airing a jingle week after week, month after month, that turned out to be such an infectious brain worm. So to make it up to you, I'm offering a free gift. The next time you make a purchase at shinybadges.com, write worms in the transaction comments, and I'll send you something weird.
Listen to LRN.FM on any phone, anytime. 213-493-0309. That's 213-493-0309.
It's Free Talk Live. You're invited here to take control of the airwaves. 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. As people all across the internet are mourning today the loss of Silk Road 2.0, yet another website targeted by the federal government goons at the FBI, targeting a site which has actually brought safety to the black market, a site that has been responsible, one of several sites, but the most most well-known, I guess, the most infamous of all of them, Silk Road 2.0, now offline. Who knows when another Silk Road imitator will spring up, and who knows whether that next imitator will be compromised from the very beginning of the operation, as this operation was. Now, is that going to mean that the people who were on the Silk Road are going to be at a greater risk? Because it is now known that behind the scenes of Silk Road 2.0, at least one of the administrators there was an undercover agent working with the Department of Homeland Security. There's an answer that I have to that question, and I'll give it here in a moment. But the toll-free number I want to give out to you is 855-450-FREE. And if you are looking for gold and silver, and you want to help protect yourself against the ravages of inflation over time, gold and silver does that very well. And you can get some, as much as you like, over at gold.freetalklive.com from Midas Resources. They got some very special rates on handpicked gold and silver pieces at Midas Resources. Go to silver.freetalklive.com or gold.freetalklive.com. They both take you to the same page. Or call them toll-free at 877-857-9938. That's 877-857-9938, or go to gold.freetalklive.com. Of course, we're also big fans of alternative currency in general, and Bitcoin is one of those alternatives that I'm a big fan of. And that's actually one of the reasons, I think in my opinion, Silk Road is one of the reasons why Bitcoin really took off. Because Silk Road was sort of the killer app, in my opinion, for Bitcoin. It was something that you could do with Bitcoin that you couldn't do with anything else in the same way. Like, sure, there have been countless drug transactions that have been made with cash, no doubt about it. But most of
the CIA does it all the time.
Sure, but most of those transactions are done in person. You know, if you start sending drug money through the banking system, it's not going to take them very long to put a stop to that.
Or PayPal.
Right. And so that's why drugs tend to have been a cash business, and it would have made it difficult to do long distance transactions with drugs. But Silk Road changed all of that, making it creating an anonymous marketplace where both the seller and the buyer don't know who one another is. Sure, the seller has to have an address to which to ship the product, but they don't know if the address to which they're shipping the product was actually the address of the person who bought the product.
Right.
There's no way to really prove that the receiving name on the product is the person who, in point of fact, ordered the product. If I wanted to, I could go on the whatever other drug websites there are, and order you a bunch of drugs, Daryl, and then drugs would show up at your front door, and you would have no idea where they came from.
Joke's on you. I don't have a front door.
Ah, exactly. You are homeless at the moment, living in the not a bus.
Yes.
But that's your home. I mean, it's your chosen.
Right. Place. Right.
I wouldn't be surprised too, though, if countless teenagers were ordering to their parents' house.
Absolutely, and their grandmother's house.
Known people that have used it, and they've changed their name just slightly enough to where they'll wind up putting the first letter of the last name as a middle initial, and then capitalize the second letter of the last name.
Gotcha. Toll-free number tonight, 855-450-FREE. And then there's also, more details about what the Silk Road was and why it was so effective. But basically, they had an anonymous marketplace where the anonymous sellers could receive anonymous feedback. They could, you know, if you had a bad experience with somebody, you could put negative feedback on that person's rating, and that might affect whether or not people would do business with them in the future.
So in a lot of ways, it was like eBay.
Very much like that, as a matter of fact. And now it is gone, Silk Road 2.0 offline. Last year, however, they took down Silk Road 1.0, and there was some discussion on the show earlier, Daryl, between you and I, about what the feds were saying about how they took down the first server, how they found the IP address information. And it turns out you were right that the U.S. government did claim to have sort of abused a CAPTCHA feature on the front page of Silk Road 1.0 to try to get it to reveal the IP address somehow of this. There's a story here from Krebs on Security, though, that's worth refreshing our audience on here in this case, to because there are some people who are calling that story into question. The claims that the feds are making, some people are saying they're BS. Now, the government released some court documents back in September claiming that FBI, in September of this year, claiming that FBI investigators were able to divine the location of the hidden Silk Road servers because of the community's login page employing an anti-abuse CAPTCHA service that pulled content from the open internet, thus leaking the site's true internet address. But lawyers for the Silk Road's alleged captain, Ross Ulbricht, asked the court to compel prosecutors to prove their version of events, and indeed, discovery documents reluctantly released by the government this week appear to poke serious holes in the FBI's story. For starters, the defense asked the government for the name of the software that the agents used to record evidence of the CAPTCHA traffic that had allegedly leaked from the Silk Road servers. The government essentially responded that it could not comply with that request because the FBI maintained no records of its own access, meaning that the only record of their activity would be in the logs of the seized servers.
And that doesn't really seem surprising, because if you recall from Rich Paul's trial, the guy that was doing, you know, the investigation or the interview or whatever it is you want to call it, admitted, no, we don't record these things.
That's right, and they just have that policy, basically.
So it doesn't seem surprising at all. Yeah, we don't keep records of how we gather evidence. We just, you know, like, we have it.
The response that holds perhaps the most potential damage to the government's claim comes in the form of a configuration file, a PDF taken from the seized servers. Or no, excuse me, they PDF the file. Anyway, Nicholas Weaver, a researcher at the International Computer Science Institute, ICSI, and at the University of California in Berkeley, explains potential significance. He says the IP address listed in that file was the front-end server for the Silk Road. Apparently, Ulbricht had split architecture where the initial communication through Tor went to this front-end server, which in turn, it just did a normal fetch to the back-end server. It's not clear why he set it up this way, but the document the government released shows the rules for serving the Silk Road web pages, and those rules are that all content, including the login CAPTCHA, gets served to the front-end server but to no one else. This suggests that the web service specifically refuses all connections except from the local host and the front-end web server. Translation? Those rules mean that the Silk Road server would deny any request from the internet that wasn't coming from the front-end server, and that includes the CAPTCHA. So the CAPTCHA file, or the configuration file, was modified on June 6th. So on June 11th, when the FBI said they saw this leaky activity, they could not have seen the CAPTCHA by connecting to the server while not using Tor. You simply would not have been able to get the CAPTCHA that way because the server was designed to refuse all requests. I know that's a lot of technical information there. But essentially, they're just saying these experts that have looked at the setup here have said that whatever the FBI is claiming they did, they couldn't have actually done. So how did they actually find the IP address of this server? What's the real story? Did they use the NSA? Was it the NSA that somehow gave them that information and they can't reveal that? Because that would be illegal?
Probably.
It's Free Talk Live. More coming up here in moments. I don't know.
Are you ready to surrender your right to buy body armor? No joke. Congress is now trying to outlaw civilian body armor. And if House Bill H.R. 5344 becomes law, you can kiss your right to protect yourself against rifle bullets goodbye. Don't put off your body armor purchase any longer. Go now to InfidelBodyArmor.com. Thousands of military veterans trust their lives to Infidel Body Armor. You should too. Spelled I-N-F-I-D-E-L. Infidel Body Armor. Just won't quit.
We've been patiently waiting. Waiting while you tried to ignore us. Waiting while you acted like we didn't exist. Waiting for our chance to be taken seriously. The wait is over. GCN is available 24/7 at GCNlive.com. Navigate through news from your favorite hosts and download archives of past shows. Download the app on your smartphone or tablet or visit GCNlive.com for instant access and live streaming. GCNlive.com, the future of talk radio, now at your fingertips.
Hey guys, Mark Claire here, LionsOfLiberty.com, where we strive to advance the ideas of liberty daily. We bring you The Morning Roar! That's right, every Monday to Friday, we'll have a brand new edition of The Morning Roar, where we provide a roundup of some news stories that you may not find in the mainstream media, or even in your typical social media news feed. We find stories that relate to the ideas of liberty and provide you with our liberty perspective on them. Every Monday, we have our longest-running feature, Mondays with Murray, named after the great libertarian Murray Rothbard, where we'll examine an article or an excerpt from his works and help convey his view, along with our little spin as well. We wrap it all up every Friday with Felony Friday, where our own John Odermatt goes out and takes a look at some sort of felony. There's felonies committed every day, you know, whether it's a felony committed by the police, a politician, or even an average citizen. You can find all of this and so much more over at LionsOfLiberty.com. Advancing the ideas of liberty daily.
Ross Ulbricht was arrested by the FBI in 2013 and charged with victimless crimes in relation to allegedly operating the Bitcoin-based Silk Road black market. He has been in a prison cell awaiting trial ever since. If he did it, he's a hero for making the black market a safer place. If he did not, he's a man wrongfully accused. Either way, if you love freedom and want to end the war on drugs, Ross and his family need your support. You can learn more and help fund his defense at FreeRoss.org. That's FreeRoss.org.
Here's a chance to do a little activism while you're cruising Facebook, Twitter, or Google+. Between the LOL cats, the recipes, the hot girls, and the inspirational sunrise memes, Free Talk Live's posts pass by your newsfeed. Like them. Comment. It gives us more exposure. If you don't see our posts, click like at facebook.freetalklive.com and then hover over it to click get notifications. It's an easy way to spread the ideas of liberty a bit further. I know you're busy, but you can spare that tenth of a calorie it takes to click on something. Facebook.freetalklive.com.
Since time began, tyrants have taken aim at personal liberties. Now there's a movie that aims back.
The government has no more right to tell us what to put in our bodies than they have to take our guns or tell us what books we can read.
Six drug police were eaten by bears while raiding a marijuana farm.
On your knees, you dirty hippies!
Jesus.
On your knees!
What's the problem, officer?
Today, many cops who enforce pot laws do so only because it provides them with cushy jobs, good benefits, and a chance to push people around.
I was an undercover narcotics officer. The drug war is nothing but a farce.
The Second Amendment says you gotta keep you and your gat intact.
Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom. A film by Michael W. Dean and Nima Vadavi.
DVD available now at gunsandweed.com or on Amazon. That's gunsandweed.com. Makes the perfect gift. Remember, that's gunsandweed.com.
You can interact with other LRN listeners in our message board at forum.lrn.fm. That's forum.lrn.fm.
Free Talk Live. Dial in toll-free here at 855-450-FREE. That is the Pro XPN toll-free line. It's 855-450-3733. Look, if you care about your privacy, that's somewhat what we've been talking about here tonight. You got to take steps. And you don't have to go as crazy as the people who are operating the Silk Road. And in fact, it looks like they didn't go far enough. But you can take some basic steps that are going to help protect you against some of the most common snooping, like your internet service provider logging all the websites that you visit and logging all of the search terms that you enter, maybe keeping those logs for as long as 5 years in some cases. You can go to proxpn.com/FTL and grab ProXPN's free application for Windows, Macintosh, iOS devices, or Android devices. Plus, if you're a Linux user, there's a way to get ProXPN working for you. It's actually fairly simple. Just go to proxpn.com/FTL to get started, and they will encrypt your internet connection, which means your ISP and other people who might be trying to snoop on your Wi-Fi packets, they're not going to be able to know what you're doing online. And you can start that by going to proxpn.com/FTL. Again, there's a free account, but you're going to want to upgrade to the premium account so you can get unlimited bandwidth. You can get servers around the world that you can access privately torrenting. You can do that with ProXPN. Plus, you can get past regionally blocked websites. And you can do it all for about $5 a month with discount code FTL50, which gets you 50% off the price of the annual account. And that savings is good for the lifetime of your account. So go to proxpn.com/FTL. You can also use code FTLBTC, and you'll save 62% off the annual account there, but you have to pay with Bitcoin with code FTLBTC. That's proxpn.com/FTL. You get it all with a risk-free 7-day money-back guarantee, and ProXPN does not keep records of your online habits at all. So proxpn.com/FTL. Codes are FTL50 and FTLBTC. It's a great discount on privacy that is priceless. We're talking about the Silk Road takedowns, mostly Silk Road 2.0, but also Silk Road 1.0 to a lesser extent. Talking about the details just a moment ago about how Silk Road 1.0 was ostensibly ferreted out. And we don't know anything yet about how they found the server location on Silk Road 2.0. But the federal government's claim was that they had exploited a weakness in the CAPTCHA, the little thing that you type the letters and the numbers into to prove you're a real human being. They'd exploited some sort of weakness in that, allegedly. And the security experts are saying, well, that's bunk. They're saying the FBI is, they're lying. And they didn't find it that way. We don't know how they found it, but they didn't find it that way. And there's a little bit more evidence that goes to that point here from the article at Krebs on Security. That's KrebsOnSecurity.com. So the feds or the FBI claims they found the Silk Road server by examining plain text internet traffic to and from the Silk Road CAPTCHA, and that it visited that address by using a regular browser and then received the CAPTCHA page. So they claim that this CAPTCHA thing on the front page of this hidden service, Silk Road hidden service, which is, you know, inaccessible from the average browser, that it somehow revealed this IP address after they hit it enough time with login information. They then went to that IP address and saw the very same CAPTCHA thing come up when they went to the IP address directly, not going through Tor. But the security expert who analyzed their logs, and he looked at the logs that the feds released from the Silk Road server, he says it tells a different story. He says that what happened is the FBI provided this evidence. It shows that, no, what happened is they didn't see leakage coming from that IP. What happened is they contacted the IP directly and went to a PHP MyAdmin configuration page. Now, PHP MyAdmin is like a back-end configuration tool that you can kind of use to set up PHP and, you know, whatever other details that you need to on your computer, your server. So they went to that MyAdmin page, and it's hardly a satisfying answer as to how the FBI investigators located the servers. After all, if the FBI investigators contacted the page, that admin page, directly, how did they know to do that in the first place? And that is still the $64,000 question, according to the expert here. He says, so both the CAPTCHA couldn't leak in the configuration they had set, because he looked at the configuration file, so he knew the government was lying about that, and the IP the government visited wasn't providing the CAPTCHA, but instead a MyPHP or PHP MyAdmin it administrates. This leaky CAPTCHA story is full of holes. So we still don't really know. We know what they're claiming, right, but we also know that the security experts who've analyzed the logs that have been released are saying what they're claiming is bunk.
And we also know that what they're claiming is hacking. Like, they are claiming to have hacked the site, mm-hmm, but they're not using the term hacking. And it doesn't really matter if they use that term or not, because they've written the Computer Fraud Abuse Act in such a way as to where government people can hack all day long, and it's not legally hacking.
Let's go to David. He's in San Francisco. You're on Free Talk Live. Hey, David.
Hey, howdy, y'all. The other day, I called up Kim Komando's show because I had a question that was sort of similar to what you're talking about. First of all, is this Silk Road, is this a program or is this a private company?
Well, it's definitely not a private company in that it's not incorporated in any way. Silk Road is a website, or was a website. It's now no longer online. But Silk Road was a website that existed in what's called the dark net, the deep web, if you will, the Tor system. and it was operated by certain individuals who were operating the site for the purpose of making money and providing people with a place to buy and sell virtually anything in the world.
Oh, I see. Okay. I thought, so I was kind of tied to the, good grief, what's the name of the kind of online currency that people
Bitcoin. Yes, Bitcoin, in point of fact, right. You had to use Bitcoin in order to use the Silk Road. There was no other payment option besides Bitcoin.
Oh, I see. Yeah, so I guess basically what you're talking about is was this like the NSA was spying on them?
Well, that's the thing. We don't know yet for sure how it was the FBI found the servers. So the thing about these hidden sites is they're called hidden sites because you can't easily discern. No one can easily find the location of the servers. Also, the location of the users are protected as well. So the only way that you can really be identified is through mistakes that you make online, like by revealing your own personal information or something like that, or turning on JavaScript. There are other ways during your Tor experience that you could put yourself at risk.
Well, the reason I ask, on Commando's show the other day, there was a sort of a side comment that we got into, because she was asking, or she was mentioning that Facebook, for example, gave the value of every Facebook user at approximately $5. Now, remembering 10 or 15 years ago, when .com was booming, people's identity was worth like $10 back then. And you would think the time value of money would have brought it up to 50 or a couple of $100 by now. And the idea that Facebook is declaring that each of our value is only like $5, then where is the share price of Facebook? Now, if you were to then look at...
I don't know. It sounds like a bunch of gobbledygook to me. I mean, look, you're only worth a little bit of money with Facebook because you're one of a billion users, or however many users they have. When you start getting quantity volume of whatever the asset or the information is, you have to break the price down. It doesn't become more valuable as you add more people to it. You have to kind of give people a break. If I've got a database that's worth a million, that has a million names in it, that doesn't necessarily mean that it's worth four times as much as a database with 250,000 names in it. Not necessarily.
Well, I mean, I could see where if somebody living in Sudan making $100 a year gets added to the mix, you know, then obviously that's going to bring the value down.
Well, that's another good point, right? Because Facebook is a global website, and
right.
Your value is what you might buy in product, right? Like the, how likely are you compared to other Facebook users to actually click on an advertisement and purchase something? And, I don't know how often that happens among 100,000 Facebook users. How many of them actually click on an ad? I doubt it's, 5% of them. Thanks for the call, David.
Sure.
Toll-free number tonight, 855-450-FREE.
And a lot of the traffic is massively bogus, and Facebook hasn't done anything about it. There's all these fake ad farms in countries like India and, in Russia and whatnot, and they're out there fake clicking, and Facebook doesn't care. In fact, they want to promote it.
We'll come back with more, 855-450-FREE.
Have you thought about owning gold? There are lots of reasons to own precious metals. A hedge against inflation. When the dollar tanks, metals go up. A barter currency. You can disempower the Fed by using real money. And no one knows the future. In an economic collapse, metals are likely to be a currency. Do as I've done for years. Buy your gold and silver and precious metals from Midas Resources through gold.freetalklive.com. That's gold.freetalklive.com. Ross Ulbricht was arrested by the FBI in 2013 and charged with victimless crimes in relation to allegedly operating the Bitcoin-based Silk Road black market. He has been in a prison cell awaiting trial ever since. If he did it, he's a hero for making the black market a safer place. If he did not, he's a man wrongfully accused. Either way, if you love freedom and want to end the war on drugs, Ross and his family need your support. You can learn more and help fund his defense at FreeRoss.org. That's FreeRoss.org.
Hi folks, Ronnie McMullen here for Life Change Tea. Healthcare is a problem, whether you're for or against Obamacare. It's a mess. My question is, who do you trust? Do you want to be told what to do, or do you want to make your own decision? My opinion, preventative maintenance. Keeping your colon clean is preventative maintenance. a little exercise, a balanced diet, and drinking Life Change Tea. It tastes great, and it helps with constipation, high cholesterol, liver problems, acid reflux, and much, much more. And with the holiday season upon us, you can get some extra tea for free. Don't wait for Obama. Make your own decision. Order now. Call us at 928-308-0408. That's 928-308-0408. Or you can log on to getthetea.com. That's getthetea.com. Ridding yourself of harmful toxins is truly preventative maintenance. Getthetea.com.
Why did you move to the Shire?
I moved here to the Shire because there's other people around who take liberty just as seriously as I do.
I moved to the Shire because I saw videos of people challenging authority and thought that I could get support myself. It called to me, like, do this right now.
I wanted to be around people like me who got it. And once I got here, I knew there was nowhere else that I wanted to be.
I've always wanted to change the world. So I moved to the Shire to join people who were actually working towards doing the same thing.
The people here are awesome, loving, and positive. It was for the adventure and for the feeling of something important is happening here. And I just wanted to come to sort of be part of that.
Visit ShireSociety.com to read and sign the Shire Society Declaration and learn the reasons why, if you love liberty, you should immigrate to the Shire. Plus, add yourself to the Shire map at ShireSociety.com. That's ShireSociety.com. So you've heard all 3 hours of the latest episode of Free Talk Live, and you're still hungry for liberty-oriented audio content? Did you know that we have another 24/7 audio stream at LRN.fm? The Liberty Radio Network airs the latest episodes of some of the best liberty-oriented podcasts on the internet, around the clock. In addition to recorded content, you'll also hear live shows like Free Talk Live, originating from our Keene, New Hampshire studio. So listen anytime at LRN.fm. That's LRN.fm.
Why does a U.S. orthodontist make more than some CEOs? You get that dental bill and you'll know. Implants, partial or full bridge, the kids need braces, fractions of U.S. prices. Balloon angioplasty for heart patients in the U.S. is $50,000. Thailand, under $7,000. Heart bypass, joint and hip replacement, cancer, many procedures under the price of your Obamacare deductible and copay. Don't risk bankruptcy. Hit us up now. We'll show you how at AsiaRunLikeHellGuide.com.
If you enjoy LRN.fm, please contribute to your favorite shows via their websites and become an amplifier at amp.lrn.fm. That's amp.lrn.fm.
Free Talk Live, you can bring up anything here. The number is 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. Long live the dark net. The takedown of Silk Road 2.0 will, of course, only be a minor inconvenience for those who were on the Silk Road that don't know about the other options. And it's only a matter of time before they find out about them, because pretty much any forum you go to where the Silk Road takedown of today is being discussed, there are threads about where else can you go? What are the other options in the marketplace? Now, apparently, according to some claims, a couple of the other sites out there are also down. Now, whether or not the FBI is claiming responsibility for that is another question. Or maybe it was just that the operators on those sites felt the heat coming on and figured they'd better cut and run, or use that as an excuse to clean out the accounts of all of the people that had accounts on their site. That's also a possibility as well. Now, one of the questions, or one of the points that was made on the Free Talk Live Facebook page when I posted this earlier, or posted some of the information about this, somebody claimed that they thought that this was a honeypot, as it is called, from the very beginning. Now, do either of you know how to define what a honeypot is?
It's that thing that Pooh Bear carries around and he sticks his hand in. And, yep. You know, there's a rumbly in my tumbly. Time for something sweet.
In this case, the honeypot is a similar idea, but more a little more complicated.
To attract flies. No, it's to attract, a fake. It's a trap.
It's a trap.
So that has always been the suspect about Silk Road 2.0, is that the feds were involved from the very beginning and that it was a trap. And it turns out there was a federal agent who was involved from the very beginning. But does that mean that the site itself was a honeypot? I don't know if that necessarily is the case. There was an agent who was working as an administrator on the site. That much is true. But one of the major changes that was made to the Silk Road 2.0, again, the sites looked very similar. Silk Road 1.0, 2.0, same graphic scheme. Everything looked very similar. But one of the big changes was that Silk Road 2.0 required PGP encryption on all address communications. So to further clarify what that means, previously in Silk Road 1.0, when they went in and they imaged the entire server, the FBI found the server. We still don't know how exactly. They found the server. They took an image. They took a snapshot of all the data on that server, and they copied all that information. Well, when they did that, they also successfully copied all of the current messages that were, you know, going back and forth between users
right.
on that system. And when you were to purchase something on Silk Road 1.0, you obviously have to give the seller an address to which mm-hmm. to ship that product. Well, on Silk Road 1.0, there was no requirement that the address that you would give would be encrypted. So you could just type in plain text your address, and then it would go into the system. And if the right. FBI happened to raid and get a copy of the server, they'd have a copy of the message saying, oh, well, I just ordered such and such and such drug or right. fake ID or whatever it was, and now ship it to this address, which of course would make it more likely to have been tied to you, mm-hmm. Perhaps, if they had that information. So one of the big changes they made in Silk Road 2.0 is they required everyone, every single person who was buying something, to encrypt their address before sending it to the seller, which would mean that if the FBI got a hold of Silk Road 2.0's server information, which they did, that they would have no one's shipping address, that all of the shipping addresses there would be completely encrypted.
In theory.
In theory, what do you mean?
Well, somebody has to have the private key or public key or whatever to unencrypt those addresses. Mm-hmm. Is it possible that one of the admins was able to obtain that?
No, not because of the way PGP works. And now we're getting into a little bit more of a technical discussion, but essentially the PGP, and please, Johnson, correct me if I misspeak mm-hmm. any of this. PGP is a kind of a bit of a hassle, but it does work.
Right, that's why I've never used it, yeah, because it's a pain.
It does work very well, I mean, doing what it does. And so when you're encrypting information with PGP, so for instance, the idea is you encrypt your address and then send that to the seller of whatever the product is that you're buying.
Okay, so I encrypt something and then I give it to you. Johnson's sitting over here. I've been told by one of the guys that was on the tech panel mm-hmm. at Keenvention that there's a way that you can run what they call a monkey in the middle, and you can find everybody's encryption info if they're running it through you.
No, the reason why that wouldn't work, as I understand it, is that what has happened is when you encrypt the information, when you encrypt the address or whatever, you're encrypting it with that other person's key. So the only person who has that key is the other person. They don't have you're encrypting it based on what they have, their public key, and then they give out their public key to everybody.
Okay.
And then the public key, there's also a private key that's associated with that.
Okay.
And the person who has that identity is in, you know, they keep their own private key private. You don't give that out to anyone. And so when that message comes in, the only way you can read that message is if you have that private key and if you have the password that accesses that will access that private key. So it makes it next to impossible for somebody else to be able to decrypt that information unless they have your private key and
so,
your password.
Right. Johnson,
the man in the middle attack would be if somehow you were able to use a man in the middle attack to steal the private key. But that's
like, yeah. Right, but I'm running the info through your website.
No, you're not running. The only info you're running through the website is encrypted.
It's public key.
Yeah, you're only giving out a public key. So everyone on Silk Road 2.0 has to have everyone who's a seller has to have a public key that they put out there, and then each buyer uses that key to encrypt a unique message that can only be decrypted by the person with that public key. The only way that that could be compromised is if the person who has the private side of that public key were to give that private key away, which would be a really dumb thing to do.
Right.
So maybe you can explain this monkey in the middle sort of scenario that, you know, Steve, he you know, the guy that was on the Keenvention panel, he's tried telling me, you know, like, you should never send information through a third party website because then they will decrypt your stuff and like give it to the NSA and something. So therefore PGP is bad.
Yeah, that doesn't even make sense. I mean, that's all I can say about it. I mean, if you're sending your information through a third party, as long as you're not sending your private key through that third party, if you send your private key through that third party, then you've just compromised your security.
That's right.
But if you're not sending your private key through that third party, then it doesn't matter. You know, you can send whatever information you want through a third party web server, as long as you and the person who you're trying to communicate with have not given up the private keys, you're fine.
So I don't think Silk Road 2.0 was a honeypot from that perspective, because they were requiring private encryption. They were requiring PGP encryption of all shipping addresses. So there was no records of people's shipping addresses available at any point on that site, unless someone happened to send their address decrypted in just a regular message communication. And even still, some of the sellers on the site required PGP communications at all. Like if you were to want to talk to them or ask them a question or, you know, communicate at all with them, they required PGP. So some went that sort of extra level of protection, others didn't. But the site was requiring people to encrypt their address, which would mean the FBI would get even less information by seizing that server. So if it was a honeypot, it seems like it was a honeypot for Blake, the guy who ultimately got charged with running the service. I don't think it was a honeypot for the people who were using the site. I don't think you're going to see, right now, or before the site was taken down, there were several thousand listings, active listings on that site. The FBI's claiming it had 150,000 active customers, you know, active participants on the site. I don't think you're going to see, 10,000 arrests. That's just not going to happen. They don't have the resources, first of all, to go after all those people. And secondly, they don't have any identifying information unless those people left identifying information purposely on their own accounts. So I don't believe that it was a honeypot. You're welcome to share your thoughts with us. Let's go to Greg in New York. You're on Free Talk Live. Hello, Greg.
Hey, guys. That was an interesting conversation that you guys are having. I know a little bit about this technology, but I wanted to, I called in to talk about something else that was on my mind.
Okay.
It was basically about the free market. I was having a conversation with some of my libertarian friends lately, the other day, and it just occurred to me, I asked them about a scenario where I said, listen, if you want to remove all political actions and just have money as the only signal, people vote with their wallet, right, not by any other means, then you could have some pretty preposterous situations. Like you could have, for example, a small community. And in this community, you know, they have obviously the private arbitration companies that settle all the disputes. And they have the private security companies that enforce these things. And then, you know, if you're a billionaire or a multimillionaire, you can, for a while, finance the takeover of these companies.
All right, hang on, Greg. We'll bring you back here. We can paint your picture in just a moment. More coming up on Free Talk Live.
Kay Oliver is part of the Tweyambe Women's Group in Jinja, Uganda. She gets old clothes, fixes them up, washes them, and then sells them at the Jinja market. She was quite happy with her success at her business, but realized that a sewing machine would really help her make more money to take care of her two kids. Free Talk Live helped her get that sewing machine. You can help us help more people by getting your coffee through coffee.freetalklive.com. Make a difference, one cup at a time. Get a free pound, try out the subscription, cancel at any time, coffee.freetalklive.com.
The event you've been waiting for is here. Lumber Liquidators' third annual fall flooring yard sale. It's your chance to get first quality, full warranty, direct from the mill flooring at unbelievable closeout prices. Like oak laminate for an incredible 19 cents a square foot. And pre-finished 3/4-inch solid maple for just $149. Plus beautiful bamboo for 63% less than other stores. Take advantage of our 20 years of savings with 20-month special financing. And get even more unheard of flooring deals in our stores. Fall flooring yard sale is Thursday through Monday only. Visit LumberLiquidators.com to find a store near you.
I love My Magic Mud. I drink a lot of coffee. I had stains on my teeth. Then I found My Magic Mud, and I was told it would remove stains. So I paid attention when I brushed the first time. My Magic Mud is black tooth powder, and the difference it made in my teeth in one application was noticeable. With four, my teeth were as white as you normal folks out there. Please go to MyMagicMud.com and buy a jar. There's 150 applications for $25. You can use Bitcoin. MyMagicMud.com.
Free Talk Live has partnered with Amazon, the largest internet retailer. Imagine a department store category, and Amazon has it. Books, electronics, office products, furniture, jewelry, automotive, toys, clothing, sporting goods, and dozens of other categories. Now you can shop and support Free Talk Live by entering Amazon through our website. Go to shop.freetalklive.com, and Amazon will send us a portion of your purchase. You're going to do the shopping anyway, so remember to enter through our site at shop.freetalklive.com. That's shop.freetalklive.com.
You're listening to the live edition of Free Talk Live. Hour number three is next after the news here on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
From Keene in the Shire, the Liberty Media capital of the world, this is Daryl W. Perry, host of FPP Radio News for Thursday, November 6th, 2014. Silver is trading at $15.38 per ounce. Gold is valued at $1,148 per ounce. And according to BitcoinAverage.com, the average price of Bitcoin is $341. Antiwar.com reports one Israeli border police officer was killed and 16 others wounded, many of them Israeli soldiers or police, in a pair of car attacks in the occupied West Bank. The larger of the two incidents took place in East Jerusalem, where a van driver hit a crowd of pedestrians, including border police, at a light rail station. The driver got out of the car and attacked others with a metal pipe before being killed by Israeli police. The driver was identified as Ibrahim al-Akri, who Israeli officials say they believe was a low-ranking Hamas member. Israeli police imposed severe restrictions on the funeral of Akri and will limit it to only 35 attendees. Though the attacker was killed on the site, Israeli police moved against Akri's home in the Shofat refugee camp, sparking a round of clashes with the residents. A second, smaller attack took place in Gush Etzion, south of East Jerusalem, where a driver ran over three Israeli soldiers, injuring them. The driver in that incident has yet to be caught. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu insisted the attack was directly the fault of Palestinian President Mahmoud Abbas, while Defense Minister Moshe Yaalon accused Abbas of damaging Israeli sovereignty in occupied East Jerusalem. FPP Radio News is brought to you by Roberts & Roberts Brokerage. For over 35 years, Roberts & Roberts has been a trusted source for buying and selling your investment-grade precious metals. They now take Bitcoin for purchasing precious metals so you can turn your profits into a long-term investment. Call Roberts & Roberts today for knowledgeable advice on investing. 800-874-9760. UPI reports President Obama offered a cordial tone for Mitch McConnell and Senate Republicans Wednesday, neither conceding any specific issues nor promising any broad action in the wake of the GOP's widespread and, in many states, decisive midterm victories. Obama did, however, say immigration reform was an inevitability, but the new Congress will be offered the opportunity to draft and pass a bill before he considers executive action. Obama told reporters, obviously, Republicans had a good night, adding, "What stands out to me is the American people sent a message." Despite losing the majority in the Senate, Obama says he's looking forward to working with both houses of the new Congress on issues he knows Republicans and Democrats have common ground on, saying it's time for us to take care of business. Despite the olive branch, Obama conceded, "Congress will pass some bills I cannot sign. Congress will not like some actions I take. That's natural. That's how our democracy works." Asked about comprehensive immigration reform, Obama reiterated that it remains a top priority, and he will exercise executive privilege if the only action Congress takes is to draft a bill he won't sign. Obama says he's optimistic he will not have to bypass Congress for immigration reform. FPP Radio News is brought to you by Voluntary Islam. Why do they hate us? Is libertarianism compatible with Islam? Davi Barker answers these questions and more in Voluntary Islam and other essays. He advances the voluntarist cause with analysis of the confluence of values between Islam and libertarianism, as well as contemporary movements from the Tea Party to the Arab Spring. Voluntary Islam by Davi Barker is available from Amazon.com and all major bookstores. Reuters reports a St. Louis circuit judge ruled on Wednesday that Missouri's ban on same-sex marriage is unconstitutional, adding momentum to efforts in states across the country to legalize same-sex nuptials. The decision comes a day after a federal judge ruled that neighboring Kansas also was violating the U.S. Constitution by refusing to allow same-sex marriages. In his ruling, St. Louis circuit judge Rex Burleson said that the freedom to marry is a fundamental right and liberty deeply rooted in the history of the United States. He found that the state ban on same-sex marriage was not tied to a, quote, legitimate government interest, end quote. Missouri officials were attempting to uphold the state ban on same-sex marriage after St. Louis officials issued marriage licenses in June to four same-sex couples. Missouri Attorney General Chris Koster said the state was appealing the ruling to the Missouri Supreme Court, but Koster said he was not seeking a stay of Burleson's ruling. This has been FPP Radio News, online at fppradio.com.
Inclement weather prevents a liar from getting to work, and a lunchbox is mostly medication. Sources across the nation impatiently reported today that the 24-hour news cycle seemed to be taking forever, telling reporters that the continuous coverage from MSNBC, CNN, and other news sources was simply not continuous enough. Frustrated Americans demanded more panel coverage, around-the-clock bulletins, and breaking reactions from Twitter.
It's like, sure, I have five channels of unending news updates constantly flooding my screen, but each one of those only has one slow-moving news ticker. Why not three or four running at triple speed? Honestly, these networks need to understand that I can't just wait around all day for minute-by-minute coverage.
And in this week's science news, a new report finds that lake ice grows safer to venture out on with each beer consumed. In other news, the beauty industry announces a new initiative to make women self-conscious about their palms. A beautiful cinnamon bun is too good for this world, too pure. And a picky eater is 38.
This is the Onion News Network.
Free Talk Live. Take control of the airwaves toll free at 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. Coming up, Johnson will be telling us about a restaurant embroiled in a social media war. And we'll find out what that is like to be involved in for a mom and pop restaurant. But still to come, your calls about whatever's on your mind. If you've got comments on the Silk Road 2.0 being taken down, an undercover operative, some sort of an agent on the inside of the site from day number one, according to the federal complaint. We'll continue that discussion here in moments. With you tonight, by the way, in the studio, you have me, Ian.
And Johnson.
And Daryl.
Let's go to Greg. He's in New York. You're on Free Talk Live. Hello, Greg. So you were you had started to say something there toward the end of the last hour, but we ran out of time. And Greg, just to bring our listeners up to speed, you were talking about how you believe that if only money is the only relevant vote that people have in society, that you think bad things can happen. And you were starting to kind of paint a picture of what you thought that would mean.
Right. I mean, we're all familiar with examples where political power is the only, if political power is too strong and money is not, then you get something like the USSR, and certain people could get away with murder if they're, well-connected politically. But the same thing can happen if you get rid of every other signal except money. For example, and you know, this
why would you want to get rid of, before you go on with this sort of silly scenario, why would you want to get rid of other signals besides money?
Well, my friends are, some of them are anarcho-capitalists. So they basically say that any kind of political organization is evil and the market should be completely free. In other words, if I want something to exist, I should support it with money, which I won't.
Okay, but that doesn't answer the question of why you would want to get rid of other signals. I mean, in the marketplace, there are plenty of signals besides money. There's direct feedback where you can talk to a manager at a company or talk to an employee and tell them how you feel about how you're being treated as a customer, and you can communicate that information to other people. There's word of mouth, which is one of the most the most effective ways to sink or swim a business. And yeah, I mean, to some extent, money backs that, in that if people are spreading word of mouth about a bad company, then they're not going to go there and buy things. But ultimately, that's not the only method of communication in a free market. There's plenty of ways to send signals in a free marketplace, and most of them have to do with your mouth rather than money.
Well, I mean, certainly. And listen, I'm just telling you what my friends who are anarchists are saying. There's not a lot, you know, not everyone who is a libertarian is an anarchist. But I'm specifically saying to people who say there should be no state at all, there should be no political organization of any kind. And I'm saying, look.
Well, one doesn't follow the other. I mean, maybe your friends are just really kind of shoddy at understanding the ideas of liberty. But just, you know, just because somebody calls themselves an anarchist doesn't mean they understand what the free market is all about. Many anarchists are not in favor of true freedom. They just like the idea of taking down the status quo.
Well, I'm also, you know, coming as somebody who kind of is an anarcho-capitalist.
You describe that way?
Well, no, I wouldn't describe it that way. But
no, you describe yourself that way as an anarcho-capitalist.
Yeah, I might, depending on my mood. But you know, my question that I would wonder is you're immediately throwing his friends under the bus, and I'm kind of wondering whether or not he's interpreting what his friends are saying correctly.
Yeah, maybe, Greg.
Right. I've spoken to them for years about this, and the scenario I proposed, they actually agreed with it that it would be preferable, and that's what shocked. Basically.
We're kind of losing your signal there, Greg. I'm going to put you on hold here. I want to give you a chance to sort of describe the scenario, but I wanted to object to it beforehand simply because I think it's premised incorrectly. That, you know, it's premised on this false idea that, oh, well, without the political system, there will only be money to influence other
people
organizations.
People won't communicate.
Right. It just doesn't make any sense to me. And Greg did drop off the line. I presume he's going to
be calling
back.
People will just walk around downtown New York throwing dollar bills at people, never saying a word.
Right. And money isn't good enough. I mean, money is an indicator that, like, if you're, the revenue to your business goes down, that could be an indicator you're doing something wrong. But you'll never know you'll never know what it is you're doing wrong if you're doing something wrong if you don't get anybody giving you feedback and saying, oh, well, I'm not spending my money at your business because your manager treated me like crap the other day when I had a problem and he didn't resolve it in the way that I was expecting. If customers don't communicate verbally through a physical conversation or through email or through a phone call, then those businesses won't be able to identify the problem, whatever it is that's causing them the issue with unhappy customers. They won't be able to appropriately identify it and fix it. And so that's one of the reasons why if something happens at a business, I want to give somebody more information. I don't want to just, you know, you don't want to just stiff somebody on a tip or whatever. You want to talk to someone and let them know what went wrong. So and that's if you care. And I like to see a business succeed rather than fail. I'd rather let them know what they're doing wrong.
And speaking of, you know, money being able to solve everything, have you guys ever noticed in like the TV shows and movies that have like a medieval sort of setting? There was never a conversation from a shop owner of how much something cost. Somebody would just like hand him a bag of silver and be like, I would like a room and fresh meals and send me a hooker. And things got done. And the guy never said, you owe me like another ounce and a half of silver. It was just, oh, you gave me a bag of silver and here's your things.
Share your thoughts. Toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. Dave's in New Hampshire. You're on Free Talk Live, Dave.
Hey, guys. Can you hear me okay?
This sounds like Dave Ridley from RidleyReport.com. And, yes, you sound fine. Go ahead.
The hey, guys part always gives me away. But I have I've got a bone to pick with you, but an improvement to suggest. You guys had been talking about the Pledge of Allegiance during an earlier show.
Okay. It's been a little while, but yes. We've certainly talked about that.
The Pledge of Allegiance certainly could be improved by not happening.
Actually, your suggestion, I think the consensus, I got the impression, was, you know, don't stand for the Pledge of Allegiance and don't say it. But I have a better idea. Our Buckminster Fuller, I think it was, said that rather than just fighting something, what you want to do is replace it, right? You want to have competition for it.
Okay.
So I found an internet meme, and I've gradually improved it over, you know, the last year, I guess, as I go to government meetings. What I do is I don't try to avoid necessarily standing or saying the pledge, but I just say a different pledge. And I'll say, and to the empire for which it stands, one torture state under fraud, completely visible with spying and lying to all. And I make sure people can hear.
Yeah, because I was going to say, that would be the only concern I have with that is that if everybody is chanting And they're so, you know, swept up in the heartwarming nationalistic moment of having people speaking in unison this obedience pledge that maybe they won't really be noticing what you're saying, even though you're saying something different. Well, so what sort of reactions have you gotten?
If you wanted to get attention to yourself, you could also, while saying this pledge, give the original American salute to the flag.
The more Nazi-esque
The
salute.
Bellamy salute.
Yeah, the Bellamy salute, the Nazi salute. That would draw some attention.
I would like to see at least one or more state rep introduce something to repeal the New Hampshire School Patriot Act.
Oh, no.
Which is the thing that became law in July of 2002 that requires schools to set aside a time to voluntarily say the Pledge of Allegiance.
Wow. That's terrible that exists here. So, Dave, what sort of reactions are you getting?
Well, I think it all depends on how loud you say it. But again, it doesn't really matter what people in the – I mean, it doesn't matter that much what the people and how many people in the room see you, because there's only going to be 10 or 12 people in the room probably. But it would just get video of it and put it on YouTube, and in my case, usually a few hundred people will see it. And, you know, other people might get less. But again, it's all about how loud you say it.
Yeah, I mean, there's an argument for it there. I mean, they could also say that's more disruptive, right? Like, if you are shouting your version of the pledge, trying to out-volume the other people in the area, that could be even more upsetting to them than you just sitting quietly during their pledge. So I don't know. I mean, I don't know if one particular path is less likely to lead to a punch to the face by some crazy, angry nationalist. But Dave, thanks for the suggestion here tonight. I appreciate it. Anybody not participating in the pledge in whatever way they feel comfortable, I think, is the way to go.
It's like the flying spaghetti monster of pledges.
The toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. Does that get people punched in the face, the flying spaghetti monster?
I don't know. I hope not.
All right, more coming up here in moments. You can take control of Free Talk Live, 855-450-FREE.
Do you live with stress? If you have nervousness or common everyday anxiety, we're looking for you. Because right now, we're sending risk-free supplies of a fast-acting supplement to listeners of this station. You heard right. Every listener who calls right now will learn how to get a risk-free bottle of Stress Block, a naturally derived formula that promotes feelings of calmness, alertness, and focus in just moments. Supplies for this risk-free offer are limited, so don't wait. Stress Block is a fast-acting, non-prescription formula to support relaxation without causing drowsiness. Your nervousness is guaranteed to begin fading like magic in just minutes. This special risk-free offer is for listeners of this station, but it won't last. Call us now for this exclusive Stress Block risk-free offer.
To get your risk-free supply of Stress Block, call 1-800-481-1288. That's 1-800-481-1288. 1-800-481-1288.
Hi, this is Mark Edge, host of Free Talk Live. We've been witnessing a meltdown of the very economic engine that powers this country. With a printing press tethered to Washington politicians, bureaucrats, and central bankers, how can we put our trust in paper money? For years, I've been buying gold and silver from Midas Resources, and you should too. Come see gold.freetalklive.com or call 877-357-9938 for a free book titled 10 Reasons to Own Gold. With Washington, D.C. delivering more debt and printed promises, common sense tells us the future of the trend is obvious. Everyone listening should visit gold.freetalklive.com or call 877-357-9938. I trust Midas Resources for my gold, silver, platinum, and you can too. Again, I want you to have this book, and it's free. It's gold.freetalklive.com or 877-357-9938. 877-357-9938.
I've been told no in many different ways.
I give you an order and you're going to obey it.
Well, George, you can go this way.
You can't do that and you have to leave here.
You cannot bring Simon to the rally.
Walk with me.
Well, I'm comfortable here, actually.
Whoa, excuse me. Hey.
Who do you think you
excuse
are?
Excuse me.
There is no video and audio allowed in this office.
No, I have work today. This is...
You ain't going to make it.
Wait.
You gotta go. Now.
Wait a minute.
Hey! Oh my God! Unbelievable!
Why are you running from me?
Because you're scared
of me!
What am I being detained for?
You're being served.
What is this?
You're being served.
What is this?
You're
Democrats have a funny way of telling people no. That's the sound of the men
working on the chain. Derek Jay's Victimless Crime Spree. Watch it for free and order the Director's Cut DVD at victimlesscrimespree.com.
The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. Three, give $5 a month to the AMP program. It's my firm belief that Free Talk Live's AMP program is the best use of your charitable dollar among liberty-oriented organizations. Support all the organizations you love. But make sure you give $5 a month to AMP at amp.freetalklive.com. Kay Oliver is part of the Tweyambe Women's Group in Jinja, Uganda. She gets old clothes, fixes them up, washes them, and then sells them at the Jinja market. She was quite happy with her success at her business, but realized that a sewing machine would really help her make more money to take care of her two kids. Free Talk Live helped her get that sewing machine. You can help us help more people by getting your coffee through coffee.freetalklive.com. Make a difference, one cup at a time. Get a free pound, try out the subscription, cancel at any time, coffee.freetalklive.com.
You can put the Liberty Radio Network on the air in your area. Visit broadcast.lrn.fm to learn how. Broadcast.lrn.fm.
It's Free Talk Live. You are invited here to take control of the airwaves at 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. Whether you want to talk about the next Silk Road takedown, Silk Road 2.0, it's gone. Gone, as well as the forums. There's two separate sites. There was the Silk Road site and then the Silk Road forums. They've both been taken down. During the first raid on Silk Road 1.0, I believe the forums were still up because they were being hosted at a different location. So apparently these forums were hosted in the same spot, but I'm jumping to a conclusion there. We're still learning more about it as time goes on. With you in the studio tonight, you've got Ian here.
And Johnson.
And Daryl.
And don't forget, you can connect with us via Skype. Our Skype username is lrn.fm. ISIS crisis or more hype? Antiwar.com has the answers. Antiwar.com has the facts and the readership. What Antiwar.com doesn't have is a pot of gold. The war machine has the magic of the Federal Reserve's printing press and the mainstream media on their side, and all Antiwar.com has is you. But their staff is down to a skeleton crew with minimal pay, and they're committed to keeping the website online with the best of the worst of the bad news, but they can't do it for free, and they can't do it without you. They need your donation. Go to Antiwar.com and donate or call them today. They proudly and gladly take Bitcoin. That's antiwar.com/donate. I think I've relayed as much as I possibly can, that as far as what I know about this Silk Road 2.0 takedown. Did y'all have anything else you wanted to throw out there, or any questions, anything that has been unclear to you about this discussion so far?
Not that I can think of. I'm just curious to see how many other admins are going to wind up getting arrested. Because as we know with the first one, there were at least two more arrests, possibly a few others. Mm. So, you know, it's going to be very interesting to see, you know, how far does this go?
We will see, and we'll keep you in the loop here as things continue to develop. Johnson, you brought a story in tonight that goes in a bit of a different direction. It's internet-related, but more of a real-life business. You've got a mom-and-pop restaurant embroiled in what is being called an unexpected social media war happening in Utah County, Santa Quinn.
This seems to happen. It's been happening more and more recently. I mean, there was a story. I don't know if you ever heard about it. Amy's Baking Company was a big thing for a while because the owners were kind of kooky and crazy.
Wound up going on that show.
Gordon Ramsay.
Gordon Ramsay. He was like, I'll turn your business into like a flourishing, thriving business. Hmm.
And it's actually funny. From that season, they were the only company that didn't go out of business.
Well, they're also the only ones that basically kicked him out in the middle of the show.
Right, right.
So who is this kind of guy, ironic. Some sort of business guru?
Well, Gordon Ramsay's this
celebrity chef.
Yeah, celebrity chef in the United Kingdom. He has like several different restaurants that are very successful. And he did this thing where he would go around and he would find find just kitchens that were just disgusting, like really dirty, and businesses that were run really poorly. And he would whip them to shape, you know. And
but it didn't work out.
I mean, it's so hard to continue to run a business that it's like, even after fixing the problems.
Right.
Because a lot of times they would slide back into their old ways. And,
right. Yeah. I mean, if the problem was created by you, bringing in some kind of outside expert to fix the issue is only going to be a temporary solution.
Right. And probably. Most restaurants only stay in business between like 3 to 5 years anyway.
Right.
And these were all restaurants that are like, you know, we've been hemorrhaging money. We're going to have to shut down in another month unless things change. Come save us. And he would come in and they'd have like a really great night for one night.
Yeah.
And then he would leave and then it would go back to normal.
I will say some of the later seasons, some of those restaurants have been switched around and are now successful. I mean, he would teach them what to do. It's not just like he's doing all the fixing. It's he would whip the owners into shape to say, this is how you need to manage. You know, these are the problems.
But it may have been too little too late.
Sure.
I mean, I mean, like we were talking about before, when Greg called in about communicating in the marketplace, word of mouth kills a restaurant. I mean, if you even if your food's good, if your service is bad, word's going to get around and people aren't
going to come. One of the things that they would do to combat that is he makes sure to do like a, you know, especially with restaurants where that there's a bad image problem like that, to do a major event. They completely redesign the interior of the restaurants in most cases so that it makes sure it's like got a new feel, like it's a new place, or that it's under new management, so that that word of mouth will get reversed and get fixed. Maybe. Yeah, it's always, you know.
I mean, a restaurant's a tough business anyway. I mean, even if you're good at running a restaurant, it's a highly competitive industry.
Right.
And most of them are closed within the first year, and the other remaining set of them are closed within the first 5 years.
So the story I mentioned there with the Amy's Baking Company is this, you know, these people, like, they were getting trolled.
That's this story tonight or a different story?
Different story. Okay. This is a different story that I mentioned just because they were embroiled in social media stuff where they basically tried to respond to every one of their trolls.
I wouldn't say that all of them were trolls.
That's true. But I mean, every bad review, and they're like, all you haters on Yelp, you know, like responding to every single person with, you're just vicious and vindictive.
Feeding the trolls.
We hate you all. Yeah, feeding the trolls.
The cake that I ordered from you tasted exactly like the cake that I picked up from Walmart in the bakery. F you, you don't know what a good cake tastes like.
Wow, yeah, that doesn't look good to anybody when you see a business behaving that way. We'll continue the story here. Dave's on the line, though, calling from New Hampshire. You're on Free Talk Live. Hello, Dave.
Hey, how you guys doing?
What's up, Dave? Go ahead.
Hey, I'm in the chat room there, and there's a couple of things we want to talk about with you guys.
You're on the air. Go ahead.
Well, first order of business is the shit bumper music you guys started.
You can't
playing.
Say those Bye. Things on the radio. I'm sorry about that. The toll-free number is 855-450-FREE, maybe because he's in the chat room.
If you're in the chat, maybe the chat should discuss about how they need to find it and send a better representative.
Yeah.
Because you're an S representative.
But see, they only had money to make that decision,
right?
And they could only scrounge up like 45 cents. And he's the only one that would do the job for that amount.
Yeah. Look, I'm sorry, chat room. Just so you know, this is a radio show. And if you can't be radio friendly in your calls, then you're not going to get on the air. At least you won't last for very long. And if you don't like the new music, well, too bad. 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. I'll tell you that with the new music or without the new music, it hasn't made a difference that I can tell in, you know, Free Talk Live listenership or downloads or anything like that, which is what I predicted.
I will say that the new music is a lot better than some of these, like, two-minute-long things where it's somebody giving a speech as an intro.
God.
Before
yeah,
the host starts talking.
Like something from The Matrix or something?
No. Well, that could be something, but also a lot of talk show hosts, they have these self-referential, self-loving kind of intros. Howie Carr, he is God! You know, that kind of imaging. One hand tied behind his back, he's taking on Jesus Christ.
One thing I like about the music, especially when coming back, is it's a little bit shorter. You know, it's not, you know,
Well, they're also fading it down, yeah, too, so it depends on the board operator. Toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. If you're listening to talk radio for the music beds, you might be listening for the wrong reason. Just saying. It's Free Talk Live.
I am so excited. My Ghost 80% AR-15 rifle just arrived. I bought it from Guns80.com. I've wanted an 80% AR-15 ever since my buddy Mark got his. I just had to have one. And when I was on the website at Guns80.com, not only did they have a great deal on the Ghost ARs, but I also found lots of other really cool stuff. And they're 80% specialists. At Guns80.com, they have a great selection of pistol kits and rifle kits. All of them can be legally shipped straight to your front door. 80% lowers and jigs starting at $50. 80% rifle kits, $500. Everything you need to build an AR in your home, all at Guns80.com. Cool part, 100% legal in most states. So, get your AR-15 today. I got mine. Now it's your turn. Go to Guns80.com. I can't wait to get mine built. Get your Ghost AR-15 today at Guns80.com. Go to Guns80.com. That's Guns, the number 880.com.
Do you know the difference between erudite and pedantic? If you do, you're probably pedantic. But seriously, a surprising number of erudite people mispronounce erudite, which has three syllables, not four. Say erudite, not erudite. Because you are judged by how you speak, you want to avoid common misstatements, especially if you're a job seeker. For instance, do you know the difference between imply and infer? Only a speaker can imply. Only a listener can infer. And when you say you'll be out of pocket, do you mean out of touch? Out of pocket means you're on your own dime, not yet reimbursed. And if anyone ever asks, why do you always answer a question with a question? You should reply, do I do that? Just kidding. From SurvivalSpeech.com, I'm Holland Cook.
My name is Jacob Hornberger. I'm president of the Future of Freedom Foundation, which Congressman Ron Paul awarded for having an outstanding freedom website. Write us at fff@fff.org, and we'll send you a free 3-month subscription to our monthly journal of libertarian essays and our booklet, Economic Liberty in the Constitution, which George Mason University economics professor Walter Williams praised in a recent column. That's fff@fff.org.
You can listen to Free Talk Live on the radio, podcast, satellite, webcam, and our live streams. But did you know you can listen to Free Talk Live from any phone, anywhere? Add this number to your phone, 213-493-0308. It's a long-distance call, so make sure you're familiar with your phone's calling plan. The listen lines are airing the latest episode of Free Talk Live 24 hours a day, including our live shows. Call 213-493-0308. That's 213-493-0308.
Free Talk Live, the show where anyone can call about whatever they want. And we do mean anyone.
Jesus Christ visited every tribe in America.
In America.
She's in America. Mormon. Absolutely. There's a book that
came out.
Man,
he got around, didn't he?
He was in India.
How did he get from point A to point B?
He had quite a life.
In a boat.
So they took a boat from the Middle East all the way over to North America?
Absolutely. Archaeologists went and visited different tribes and followed their myths and stuff. And none of them used the name Jesus, but they all described him as a white man with long brown hair and a beard.
Well, now, why is it that Jesus is white?
How did a white guy get born to a bunch of Sephardic Jews is what I want to know.
No.
Well, God's white, so I mean, that's how.
Of course he is.
Was the Immaculate Conception. He could make that baby whatever color he wanted to.
Free Talk Live, 7 nights a week from 7 to 10 Eastern, live on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM. You can connect with the Liberty Radio Network via our Facebook page at Facebook.LRN.FM. That's Facebook.LRN.FM.
It's Free Talk Live. Dial in toll free. Bring up anything you want. 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. Media war explodes around a mom-and-pop restaurant. A social media war. The story from KSL in Salt Lake City. With you tonight in the studio here, it's Ian.
And Johnson.
And Daryl.
Don't forget, join us online at freetalklive.com. If you like this program and you want to help support Free Talk Live, then you can become an amplifier. The AMP program stands for Advertise, Market, and Promote. And the idea is you send in $5 a month to Free Talk Live. We invest that into the show, get on more radio stations around the country, bring more internet listeners on board, exposing new people to the ideas of freedom. So you can help us with that for $5 a month. We can do more outreach to internet listeners, bring new listeners on there. We can bring new radio stations on board with Free Talk Live and maybe expand our satellite footprint. So there's a lot we can do with your $5 a month. Just go to amp.freetalklive.com. You get perks like access to the Amp Only call-in lines, the Amp Only podcast forum, the Amp Only Facebook group as well. So get all the details and get signed up at amp.freetalklive.com. Story from KSL.com, where a family-run restaurant has found itself at the center of a social media nightmare. After a now-fired worker's incendiary post about police on his own Facebook page drew outrage against the business. So in this case, this wasn't even the business itself that that had posted something upsetting.
Right.
And the business also then attempted to make things right, and that upset people. Leslie's Family Tree Restaurant in Santa Quinn is best known for its massive scones and its history of paranormal activity on the property, which makes it a regular attraction for ghost hunters. if you've never seen the Penn & Teller BS Ghost Hunters episode, it's one of the most hilarious that they've ever done.
We've got haunted scones.
Tuesday, however, the restaurant saw exceptionally high traffic on its Facebook page as commenters raged about a photo and caption that a cook posted on his personal Facebook page that suggested a good cop is a dead cop. Judy Dancy, who handles social media for the business along with her other responsibilities, said the cook acknowledged the inadvertent impact his post had on the restaurant and even suggested that he be fired. The business subsequently responded on its page with a message condemning the cook's post, acknowledging his termination, expressing an appreciation for free speech, and then offering free meals to police officers. Dancy said, quote, "We just wanted to show them how much we appreciate what they do, not thinking that could ever be a bad thing."
You know, I really think that you need Chris Cantwell here when you're making the discussion about this story.
Because he hates the police?
Well, yeah, he would be the guy defending the cook. And, you know, I think that he would have an interesting perspective on this.
Well, now, the statement that a good cop is a dead cop doesn't necessarily suggest killing police. That statement could be interpreted as, if you're a good cop, you end up dead, meaning that the bad cops will kill you. Right?
I don't think that's what most people think when
they
hear that.
I know that what you think is, you know, oh, well, this person's advocating killing. Well, if you think about it, if you're a good cop amongst a bunch of scumbag cops who are really corrupt, they might just kill the good cop if that good cop is
threatening. Or they'll force you to quit.
Yeah, maybe. But if the good cop's really doing good things and, like, trying to stop the bad guys, then he would go after, in theory, the good cop would go after the corrupt cops and possibly put his own life in jeopardy and end up dead. So I think it just depends on how you interpret that that statement. But nonetheless, the business owner in this case felt as though they needed to apologize for their employee's statement on his own personal Facebook page.
Right, which
is ridiculous.
To me,
that seems silly. Why is that ridiculous?
Well, it's just ridiculous because these companies are invading people's personal privacy and going into their Facebook. It's like, okay, so they said something that you don't like. It's still free speech. It doesn't matter whether or not it happens on Facebook. What if that person had said it somewhere else and it got back to those business owners by word of mouth? Is it still okay to fire them because they said something you don't like?
Mm-hmm.
And well, I find it kind of ironic that the owner says, we'd support free speech, but we went ahead and terminated the guy anyway.
Yeah, no, you don't. Mm-hmm. But no, I mean, and when I say is it okay to fire them, I'm not saying that, like, oh, it should be illegal to fire someone over something. I think they should be able to have their own business relationship, you know, however they want to do it, but it doesn't make them good people. And, you know, clearly they're not.
The business responded on their page, again, condemning the cook's post. She said she was surprised that people would think it was a bad thing to show the police how much they appreciate them. The restaurant's attempt to quell the initial firestorm was met with more outrage. One man posted on their page, quote, "This place gives free food to murderers and kidnappers just because they wear badges," unquote. A family member of Darian Hunt, who was shot and killed by Saratoga Springs police as he carried a samurai sword, even weighed in on the debate. Cindy Moss, his aunt, blasted the restaurant's gesture on Facebook and in a subsequent interview with KSL, saying, quote, "It makes me sick."
And she was crying and bawling during this interview. It was interesting.
It seems so awkward and messed up that people are rewarding the people who killed my nephew. Ms. Moss acknowledged the work of good police, but said she felt compelled to react because of what happened to Hunt.
Now, what's interesting, too, is this type of news story where they're actually showing the other side, where they're saying, you know, people saying, hey, these police are murderers, and people talking about, you know, violence that's happened against them. This type of story would not have happened even a few years ago. I don't think.
You mean as far as the attitude of people toward police?
Right. I just don't think that, people would be even willing to come out necessarily publicly. And the media, it just doesn't seem like they would have covered this type of thing at all. Like, they would have brushed it under the rug. And now, you know, since, Ferguson, right, it's coming out. Finally, people are opening their eyes.
That's a good point. And the fact that a business owner now feels uncomfortable for having taken a position on this at all is interesting. And she was surprised by it, because I don't know how big Santa Quinn is, but I can tell you it doesn't look like a big place. I'm just, you know.
That a business owner is getting flack for saying cops are good.
Right.
Like, all cops are heroes and we should support them.
Well, I don't think it's just that the business owner is saying, I like cops, cops are good. It's that the business owner is saying, I like cops are good, and they can have anything they want from my store.
Well, right, they're pandering.
But, yeah, they're pandering.
Santa Quinn is a small town. I just looked it up. They've got a population of 10,000. And so the business owner is pandering. You know, the small town mentality is that cops are heroes, and that the cops and the town are good guys, and, you know, nobody talks about the corruption going on, because there's corruption in every small town, likely. It's just that, you know, whether you know about it or not is another question. And some people are fed up enough. I think you're right, Johnson, that people are fed up enough. They're willing to associate their own personal Facebook profiles with their distaste for the police now.
Right.
And some business owners are behind the times. Probably,
but not just that. I think it's also the fact that the media is covering it is pretty astounding.
It's noteworthy.
Too. Well, and giving it fair and, like, giving it kind of balanced coverage, like saying, like, hey, this is what people are saying on the other side, and that this business is getting flack. For, you know, that not only are people willing to go out of their other way on Facebook and say that, hey, cops are scum or cops are bad, but also the fact that the media is willing to cover a story where a business is getting flack for saying that cops are good and offering them free stuff.
Right.
The fact that the media is not just brushing that under the rug.
And you have to wonder how much of a role websites like Cop Block played and the Free Thought Project, to where every day they're showing stories of, you know, cop charged with, you know,
yeah, not
molesting,
just a single story,
and
too, dozens of stories every day.
That there was the one story where the cop raped someone on the hood of his car.
So we'll continue here with the story. The business subsequently took down their response, along with some additional posts, Dancy said, but a number of negative reviews remain because of the Cook's post. Dancy said the Leslie Family Tree Facebook page usually gets about 75 views for one of its posts about a daily special. She estimated the page has seen around 7,000 new views due to the Cook's post and the business's initial attempt to make good. In retrospect, she says, maybe I wouldn't have opened a Facebook account because I'm considering taking it off. We have always respected everyone's freedom of speech, too, so we were literally stuck between a hard spot and a hard spot. Well, they put themselves there, and she could have just ignored the post of the guy who was working for the restaurant. She could have just left it alone and posted the next daily specials.
Right, because he didn't make the post
on the
Facebook page for the company.
If he had done that, then I would understand trying to distance themselves from it. More coming up, 855-450-FREE. 855-450-3733. Take control of the airwaves here on Free Talk Live. Here's a good idea. When you have a legal matter like creating your will or legally setting up a business with a corporation or LLC, you don't necessarily need a law firm. Use LegalZoom.com. At LegalZoom.com, you answer straightforward questions online and they take care of the rest. They even review your answers for common mistakes and guarantee your satisfaction. Free Talk Live listeners, you'll get 10% off your order by typing in FTL in the referral box at purchase. Don't procrastinate with these important legal documents. LegalZoom.com. Free Talk Live has partnered with Amazon, the largest internet retailer. Imagine a department store category, and Amazon has it. Books, electronics, office products, furniture, jewelry, automotive, toys, clothing, sporting goods, and dozens of other categories. Now you can shop and support Free Talk Live by entering Amazon through our website. Go to shop.freetalklive.com, and Amazon will send us a portion of your purchase. You're going to do the shopping anyway, so remember to enter through our site at shop.freetalklive.com. That's shop.freetalklive.com.
With autumn in the air, it's time to think about getting ready for winter. And it's time to save at HerbalHealer.com. You'll find amazing seasonal savings to prepare you for the fight against cold and flu season. Like Oregacillin to promote lung health. 30 capsules, regularly $34.95, now only $25. HHA Olive Leaf, the natural antiviral, normally $16.95, now 60 capsules are just $12. HHA Elderberry Power, a great flu and virus fighter, regularly $16.95, 60 capsules, now $10. Save on all our homeopathic detoxes. Choose from lungs, kidney, liver, brain, libido, or whole body, normally $26.95, now just $20. Visit HerbalHealer.com and click on the Fall Winter Specials button to save on all our natural cold and flu fighting products. Also, explore our Herbal Healer Academy correspondence courses that teach you how to handle your health naturally. HerbalHealer.com, healing the world with nature, one person at a time, since 1988.
I am a non-attorney spokesperson. Attention men who've taken Androgel or any other testosterone therapy products. Androgel or other low-T products have been linked to heart attack, stroke, pulmonary embolism, deep vein thrombosis, even death. Scientific studies indicate that the use of testosterone therapy products may double a man's risk of heart attack. If you or a loved one took Androgel or a testosterone therapy product and suffered from a heart attack, stroke, pulmonary embolism, deep vein thrombosis, or any other cardiac event, you might be entitled to financial compensation. You have rights, and you need to let us fight for your rights. And you pay no fees unless we win. So call the Tort Attorneys right now. 800-708-7917. 800-708-7917. 800-708-7917. 800-708-7917. Cases may be referred to participating law firms in your jurisdiction.
Did you know that you can listen to and watch Free Talk Live during our live show 7 days a week from 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern via our studio cam at cam.freetalklive.com? Not only that, but you can also chat with other listeners at the same time. Do I need to mention that both the studio cam and chat room are totally free? Outside of Free Talk Live's live hours, you won't see a cam feed, but we'll hear audio from the Liberty Radio Network. So listen, watch, and chat all free at cam.freetalklive.com. That's cam.freetalklive.com.
This is Mark of Free Talk Live. We've been witnessing a meltdown of the economic engine that powers our country. With a printing press tethered to Washington bureaucrats and New York central bankers, how can we trust paper money? For years, I've been buying gold and silver from Midas Resources, and you should too. Call 877-357-9938 for a free book titled 10 Reasons to Own Gold, or go to gold.freetalklive.com. Again, 877-357-9938, 877-357-9938.
While our satellite channel is free to listen to, it's not free for us. You can help us cover our satellite costs with the chip-in on the right side of the page at lrn.fm.
It's Free Talk Live. Moments remain here, but there's enough time for you with your call and thoughts if you dial in right now at 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. Tonight with you, Ian here.
And Johnson.
And Daryl.
Don't forget to check out more of Daryl over at his website, fpp.cc. There's kind of some big changes coming for you, Daryl, at least from the audio side of what you're doing on fppradio.com.
That will be announced Sunday Peace, Love, Liberty Radio.
So people who want to hear about those changes should listen to Peace, Love, Liberty Radio this Sunday on lrn.fm.
Yes.
So there you go. And go to fppradio.com. You can download stuff later on there. And you also get the daily newscast that you put together on a seven-day-a-week basis. That is not the news. That will not be changing. But something else will be changing.
Right. Something else will be changing. And I think it's actually going to wind up being an improvement.
Okay. All right. Good. Well, we'll talk more about that next week. Check out more of Daryl at fpp.cc. Some of his writings and audio products are all there. And most of it's totally free. So you can join us on the phones here at 855-450-FREE. We were talking about a mom and pop business stepping in it in social media. Turns out people have opinions these days about the police, and they're more than willing to share them on your Facebook page if you take a position about the police, whether in pro or against the police. People are going to be upset about that, and then you're just going to be in the middle of this conflict, which this mom-and-pop business in Santa Quinn, Utah, discovered themselves in. They didn't want to be there, and they didn't have to be there, as far as I can tell. One of their employees posted on his own personal page, and the company decided to weigh in by firing him over it.
Yep, they should have just left it alone. You know, it's not,
yes, they should have.
It's not their page. It's his personal page. It's none of their business.
They fired him, and then they also gave the police free food after that, and that resulted in a bunch of people who are less than happy with the militarization of the police, the violence that they inflict upon peaceful people, saying, hey, you shouldn't be giving food to people who hurt other people. Now, they called them murderers, which isn't a fair thing. It's not fair to call all the police murderers, but certainly they do aggress against people.
Right.
They do threaten others. They do arrest peaceful people who've never harmed another person, and business owners are now getting hurt by supporting the police, and I think that that's a good thing to some extent. I think that it's good that people are willing to express themselves to these business owners and let them know to keep their opinions about the police to themselves if they want to have a chance at being a successful business. There's more coming up here. Your calls are welcome. Brian is in New Hampshire. You're on Free Talk Live listening to WSMN in Nashua.
Hey, good evening, guys.
So, hi, Brian.
I was just curious, in general, how do you guys feel about police in general? I mean, is Free Talk Live pro? Well, is it probably not pro, but are you guys, is it fair to say you guys are anti-police?
No. I don't feel safe around police. I don't feel safer. I feel like that, you know, basically the way I feel about police is it's like, oh, I may or may not be protected by this psycho jock with a gun. That's my general attitude when I feel like I'm around police. It's like, oh, I'm being protected by this guy who, you know, maybe made his way out of high school and, you know, is, you know, hopefully going to be a good guy, you know, hopefully isn't just a bully who wants to, you know, express force over other people and is going to be a good person, has actually joined this job to do good and hasn't been corrupted by all the other scumbags who they're working with. That's generally how I feel about cops.
If the police were only enforcing crimes that actually had a victim, then I would not really have a problem with what they do.
I feel like the drug war has basically had a much broader psychological effect on the police. You know, you look back, I mean, even you look back at how the media portrayed police back when it was the Andy Griffith Show, you know, and look back then versus now with these stormtroopers in riot gear.
Yeah, so I agree with Daryl on this one. I don't have the same real kind of jaded, fearful attitude of that Johnson was expressing, but that's because I get out there among the police a lot in New Hampshire, and I have, you know, conversations with them, and I see them more as human beings.
Well,
there was one
more thing that I wanted to add.
Yeah, sure.
The only time that I've ever had a gun pointed at my face, it was being held by a police officer who responded to the wrong address when they were supposedly investigating a burglary.
Yeah. The only time I've ever been kidnapped has been by the police. I've never been kidnapped by a private kidnapper and, you know, had any of my time stolen or my money taken from me. So, yeah, I think that the police today are aggressing against peaceful people, and that's why people don't like them. That's why people are upset at them. I don't want that to happen. I want them to be out there protecting people. I want them to be, you know, arresting murderers and rapists and arsonists and people that destroy property and others who threaten people and harass. You know, that's to me what the police should be out there doing, but they're only doing that some of the time, and they're not doing that all of the time. Instead, they're spending their time on marijuana smokers, people with open container, people who roll through stop signs,
people that don't get a driver's license,
people who change their name, you know, so they do all kinds of ridiculous nonsense, Brian, and I wish that they were just more peace officers than law enforcement officers. What about you?
So, well, it's
So it sounds like you guys are anti-police.
No,
like
no. I'm pro peace officer.
Well, what's the difference? I mean, the police in general, their very first interest before they do anything else is to establish their security. And I'm not a cop. I've never been a cop. I don't pretend to be a cop.
So,
but all I'm saying is that...
So shoot all the dogs.
I want to hear what he's saying.
Their safety before they do anything else.
So if there's like a 5-pound dog there, they should shoot it in the face, right? That's what establishing security is. Well, then what are you talking about?
Not.
Because that's what a lot of these bully cops do, you know, and that happens frequently.
Yeah, I don't understand why you brought the comment up about police establishing their own security. What was the point of bringing that up?
Well, you just mentioned a moment ago that you were detained by a cop, right?
No, I was arrested. I've been arrested multiple times for civil disobedience and non-cooperation. I've never hurt anybody or caused any fraud, but yet I've spent weeks of my life behind bars.
Wow.
Yeah. I don't think that people who don't hurt other people should go to jail. I think that, you know, the only people who should be arrested are the people who are a threat to others and the people who are violent and dangerous and destructive. I mean, don't you?
I think that we have a lot of laws, and we have a lot of laws for a lot of good reasons. Maybe not all good reasons, but...
So the law that I violated on Tuesday by uploading a picture of my ballot before I put it in the ballot machine, did I harm anyone there? Should I wind up going to jail because I refused to pay the $1,000 fine?
I think that's an example of a stupid law. I mean, I'm not going to argue that there aren't stupid laws. What I am arguing is that
they should all be enforced.
No, we should get rid of laws that are.
But in the meantime, they should be enforced.
Yeah.
Why? Why?
So.
Why would you want to have them enforce bad laws?
Because it's on the books, Ian.
I want him to answer, please. Go ahead.
Isn't the point that we should get rid of bad laws? If we have laws that are stupid and stink, isn't that the point that we should get rid of those laws?
That'd be great to get rid of them, but why not in the meantime have the police not enforce them?
Well, police aren't supposed to. Police have a lot.
You don't know what you're talking about. The police have discretion on almost everything.
My answer is that they ought to enforce all the laws, or they ought to get rid of.
The police don't get rid of the laws.
You know, legislature.
So you're arguing for the police to be. You're arguing for the police to be mindless automatons. Then you're saying the police shouldn't be making decisions about which laws are good laws and bad laws. They should just enforce them all across the board, no matter how bad they are. I mean, so essentially, you're arguing for the mindless automaton police enforcement. Well, what are you saying?
That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying that police already have a wide array of discretion, and so they should enforce the laws that exist. But as a people, as a legislature, whatever,
I've completely understood what you've said. Maybe you misunderstood me restating what you said, but I've understood. You're saying the police should enforce all the laws, even though they have discretion, and the legislature should change the bad laws. In the meantime, you're saying bad laws should be enforced.
Yeah.
So basically, just to clarify, just to further clarify, Brian, what you're saying is you would have supported the enforcement of the fugitive slave laws back in the 1800s.
I'm not familiar with those laws.
They're the laws that force people to return escaped slaves.
Okay. I mean, I haven't read the law, so I don't
take my word for
it. One way or the other.
They existed. And your position is those laws should have been enforced until they would have been changed. Do you realize how inhumane and sick that is? I hope you'll think about that, and I thank you for the call tonight. We are out of time. You can join us tomorrow night.
Have some discretion, but don't use it.
Right. Please. I want police who are smart enough to make decisions about what laws are bad and what laws are good. But apparently that's crazy.
Free Press Publications is an independent, alternative media and publishing company founded in June 2009 with the mission of ensuring a free press for the freedom movement and is committed to spreading the message of peace, freedom, love, and liberty. FPP also gives new authors an avenue for publishing freedom-oriented material. FPP brings you daily news and commentary on the website, fpp.cc, as well as a daily 5-minute newscast, FPP Radio News, and weekly news, views, and commentary in the FPP Freedom Minute and Peace, Love, Liberty Radio at fppradio.com, and the monthly newspaper, FPP News, at news.fpp.cc. Find FPP online at fpp.cc. That's fpp.cc, as in Creative Commons.
Radio is the most personal of mediums. I exist right now in your head. If you listen to Free Talk Live regularly, you know me. Free Talk Live is on more than 160 radio stations around the U.S. and has been downloaded on every continent around the world. Hundreds of thousands of listeners with ad packages from $600 a month to $6,000 a month. Imagine what we can do for your business, project, website, or idea. Email me, Mark, at freetalklive.com. The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. Three, give $5 a month to the AMP program. You likely buy all kinds of things online. Amazon is the largest online retailer. You can get what you need at the same prices with free Super Saver shipping by going to shop.freetalklive.com. Please do your online shopping at shop.freetalklive.com.
The latest episode of Peace News Now is next, after the news, here on the Liberty Radio Network, LRN.FM.
This is the Liberty Beat, your daily source for Liberty news and activist updates, online at thelibertybeat.com. I'm Brian Hagan with your Liberty Beat for Thursday, November 6, 2014. Gold is trading around $1,144, silver $15.39, and Bitcoin is trading around $338. Today's Bitcoin price brought to you by ExpressCoin, the fastest and most reliable way to buy Bitcoin. Buy Bitcoin today at ExpressCoin.com. Today's edition of the Liberty Beat brought to you by our newest sponsor, eFoods Direct. Redefining the way you think about storable food. Easy to make and great tasting, with a shelf life of over 25 years. To celebrate our new partnership, eFoods Direct is offering Liberty Beat listeners 10% off their purchases. To take advantage of this exciting offer, call 800-620-5520 and mention coupon code LibertyBeat. To learn more or to buy online, visit eFoodsDirect.com. In the news, on Wednesday, thousands of protesters around the world took part in the Million Mask March, with demonstrators in Washington, D.C. and London challenging the police head-on. London police arrested 10 people after protesters clashed with police officers and allegedly committed assault. At one point, the protesters grabbed metal barriers, which separated police from the activists. In Washington, D.C., protesters also wrestled with police over metal barriers. The mass protesters in the nation's capital verbally challenged the police and called for an end to government corruption. The BBC reports Egypt's policies toward protesting citizens are under review by the Human Rights Council of the U.S.-funded United Nations. Since 2011, revolution has rocked Egypt and caused major upheaval following the ouster of longtime president Hosni Mubarak. After democratically elected Mohamed Morsi was removed by a military coup last year, military ruler President al-Sisi has been heavily criticized by U.S. and European nations for perpetrating violence against innocent protesters exercising political speech. However, the United States continues to work with al-Sisi. As during the reign of Mubarak, the United States sends Egypt roughly $3 billion in foreign aid each year. Over 2,000 people have died in the conflict in Egypt. On Tuesday, Hawaiian voters decided to ban the growing of genetically modified crops. The new measure creates a temporary moratorium on GM crops until further health and environmental studies are completed. Support for Liberty Beat comes from Central Texas Gunworks, your online source for firearms, firearm accessories, and ammunition. They take major credit cards and now accept Bitcoin. Visit them online at shop.centraltexasgunworks.com. Support also comes from Marjorie Wildcraft's Grow Your Own Groceries. Homegrown food on every table. That's growyourowngroceries.org. This is the Liberty Beat for Thursday, November 6th, 2014. Check out the website at thelibertybeat.com and like us on Facebook at facebook.com/thelibertybeat. On Wednesday, President Barack Obama said he would work with Congress on new war powers to fight Islamic State militants and expressed cautious optimism about whether the international face-off over Iran's nuclear program will be resolved. Two issues that could prove harder for the White House to maneuver with Republicans in charge on Capitol Hill. The Associated Press reports that Obama spoke at a news conference the day after his party was thrashed by Republicans in elections, leaving the Republicans soon to be in charge of both the House and the Senate. Obama's decision will test the ability of the divided Congress to agree on a war strategy for Iraq and Syria. A St. Louis Circuit judge has ruled Missouri's ban on same-sex marriages as unconstitutional. Judge Rex Burleson called the freedom to marry a fundamental right deeply rooted in the history of the United States. The news comes a day after a federal judge ruled a similar ban in Kansas was in violation of the Constitution. On Monday, a district judge threw out an alleged 1993 confession from Daniel Villegas, the Texas man who spent 19 years behind bars for a murder he did not commit. The district judge stated that the confession could not be used as evidence in an upcoming retrial because it was coerced by police. Support for Liberty Beat comes from Midas Resources Incorporated, helping clients convert their paper 401ks and IRAs to solid gold and silver. Get their 10 Reasons book free by calling 800-686-2237. That's 800-686-2237. Support also comes from Sovereign Living, a podcast, blog, and reality show about what it takes to live a voluntary and natural life. Check out the blog at sovereignliving.com and watch episode 1 of the soon-to-be-released reality show at sovereignliving.tv. This is the Liberty Beat for Thursday, November 6, 2014. I'm Brian Hagan reporting, reminding you, spread liberty with a smile.
It was on this day in 1982 that the first roller skating while carrying a boombox member of Congress was elected when James Sugar Boots Franklin narrowly won New York's 8th congressional seat. Franklin's victory was a watershed moment at the time, signaling that America's burgeoning population of boombox carrying roller skaters had finally gained mainstream acceptance.
We proved Congress isn't just for suits and crew cuts. Say hello to the slickest legislator on 8 wheels. James Sugarboots Franklin.
Franklin was an unlikely pioneer, a street smart skater who admitted to being more concerned with impressing honeys with his silky smooth moves than with politics.
Franklin began organizing boombox carrying roller skaters, advocating for basic rights like roller skate accessible ramps in government buildings and protected street lanes where they could lay down cones for some sweet slaloming.
Just because we like to roll it out and have a smooth, fluid style that cannot be denied doesn't mean we aren't Americans. Yeah, that's right.
This is the Onion News Network.
Check, check, check. 1, 2, 1, 2. Hello, it's Peace News. Welcome, we're live. It's November 4th, 2014. This Tuesday evening, it's 10 p.m. in Keene, in the Shire. I'm your host, Derek J. You can learn about me at derekj.me.